Sure, please.
Yeah, so just one second. So good morning all participants. We welcome you to the sixth day of the 6 days webinar on GST refresher course. Today the speakers are CA Rohit Surana and CA Ankit Kanodia. CA Rohit Surana will be speaking on important things from GST perspective in financial year 2019-20. And CA Ankit Kanodia will be speaking on annual return and audit for financial year 18-19 important issues. So CA Rohit Surana will be taking the first session. And I would request all participants to stay on mute. I have muted everybody to continue to remain on mute and not to unmute themselves. And kindly keep your videos off so that, you know, bandwidth, there are no bandwidth issues and you can hear the speaker very well. All questions may be put up in the chat box, and both the speakers will be taking up the questions at the end of the session. Both the speakers will be speaking for 45 minutes each, and thereafter at the end we will have the questions taken up from the chat box, and the speakers will answer the questions. Now over to DSG.
Thank you, Ritesh. And good afternoon, friends, and welcome to the last day for 6 days webinar on GST refresher. Ritesh already informed you about the topics and the speakers. I am going straight to a brief introduction of our both the speakers. CA Rohit Surana is Chartered Accountant and Company Secretary with more than 15 years of post-qualification experience. He has secured all India 19th rank in CA exam and was a school topper. He is also a holder of IMMA Charter, MLA, Jury. He is founder partner of MSS RSPA and Associates of Boutique Consulting and Advisory Firm. Leading 30 plus members, colleagues, and delivering values to clients in the field of strategy, finance, taxation, M&A, business plans, and budgets. He has contributed a number of research articles on LinkedIn, ISCI, and study circle publications, and has been an avid speaker on various forums of ICI, ICSI, GITO, TPF, and others. I welcome CA Rohit Surana in today's webinar. Our second speaker in this today's is CA Ankit Kanodia. He is a fellow member of ICI, company secretary, LLB, LLM, whatnot, with a distinction, and has done his graduation from St. Xavier's College, second 12th rank. He has gained events experience working with Big Four in the consulting industry, where he specialized in the field of indirect taxes. He is a partner of SK Kanodia and Assets since 2012 and heads his indirect tax practice arm. He handles the firm's major departmental assignments before the adjudicating authorities and various separate authorities, including SESTAT. An impaneled faculty of ICI, a key resource person of Kolkata Study Group, he is a co-opted member of IDT Committee of the Bengal Chamber of Commerce and Industry and various other associations. He has been invited to over 100 events across India, vacancy jada hoga, to share his knowledge about GST through lectures. He authored two books on service tax, ready reference, and BEREX, Law Point publication in Kolkata, and also published numerous articles in various journals and magazines. He is the editor of monthly GST bulletin, GST Navigator, from the house of SKKA. I welcome CA Ankit Kanodia, who also happens to be the vice chairman of DTPA GST and IDT committee, in today's show webinar. And now request CA Surana to start his deliberation. Over to CA Rohit Surana. Happy learning.
Thank you, Agarwalji. Good afternoon, everybody. This grim period of lockdown, I start by wishing everybody happy Poila Vaisak, Bihu, Vaisakhi, Puthandu, Vishu. इतने सारे हम लोगों के festivals चल रहे हैं और बहुत-बहुत साधुवाद है सभी को जो ऐसे festival में भी बहुत ही संयम रखते हुए हम लोग ये lockdown का coming to GST portion, एक चीज हम सब जानते हैं, we know this particular thing very well from last 3 years, that 31st March we are going to close our books of accounts. 30th September का return जो जाएगा GST का, वो लास्ट डेट है कि 1920 का जो भी एडजस्टमेंट्स करना है हमको जीएसटी में वो हम 30th सितंबर तक कर सकते। तो ये जो 31st मार्च और 30th सितंबर के बीच का जो समय है उसमें हमको 1920 के लिए क्या क्या चेंजेस करना है, व्हाट आर द इफेक्ट्स दैट वी नीड टू कीप इन माइंड, वी नीड टू मेक इन द बुक्स ऑफ अकाउंट्स, वी नीड टू मेक इन द जीएसटी रिटर्न्स फॉर अप्रैल टू सितंबर, सो दैट one we can comply with the law, second we do not miss out on any unnecessary ITC credit, third we are not subject to any unnecessary penalty or interest. ये तीन चीजें को दिमाग में रखते हुए मैंने समय की संयमता को देखते हुए कुछ पॉइंट्स नोट डाउन किए हैं जो आप लोग काम में ले सकते हैं। सबसे पहला पॉइंट मैं आना चाहूंगा, एक मिनट, हेलो, हाँ सॉरी फॉर इंटरप्शन। So, सबसे पहला पॉइंट जो है और ये पॉइंट बहुत ही इम्पोर्टेंट है जिसको मैं साथ साथ में डिस्कस करूंगा, एक है क्रॉस चार्ज के इनवॉइसेस और दूसरा है इनपुट सर्विस डिस्ट्रीब्यूटर। पहले समझते हैं कि क्रॉस चार्ज क्या होता है और इसको लेकर हम आज लॉ के क्लैरिटी में कहां तक पहुंचे, क्योंकि शेड्यूल वन क्लॉज टू ऑफ जीएसटी एक्ट 2017 हमें बताता है कि हमारे जितने भी ब्रांच ऑफिसेस हैं जो एक स्टेट के बाहर है, फॉर एग्जाम्पल हमारा एचओ कलकत्ता में है, हमारा ब्रांच दिल्ली में हो सकता है, गुवाहाटी में हो सकता है, चेन्नई में हो सकता है, हैदराबाद में हो सकता है, ये हमारे सारे ब्रांच ऑल्दो एक ही कंपनी के हैं बट जीएसटी पर्पसेस के लिए दे आर डिस्टिंक्ट पर्सन, मतलब उनको जीएसटी लॉ के अंदर दे विल बी ट्रीटेड एज सेपरेट पर्सन। इन अंडर दीज सर्कमस्टेंसेस any transaction between these distinct person whether for consideration or not will be treated as supply under GST. ab iska main aapko udaharan leke samjhata hu, samjhiye ek company hai jo jiski head office Calcutta mein, iske sare branch all over India phale hain, ab head office un branch ko kya kya services de sakta hai, for example कॉमन मार्केटिंग डिविजन एचओ में बैठे, सो पूरे इंडिया का मार्केटिंग जो है वो एचओ से होता है। सिमिलरली एचआर फंक्शन जो है वो सारा कलकत्ता में बैठता है, तो सब जगह की रिक्रूटमेंट जो होती है वो यहीं से देखा जाता है। अब आप एक ब्रांच समझिए दिल्ली, यहाँ पे दिल्ली में जो भी मार्केटिंग हो रहा है उसकी सारी एक्टिविटीज का जिम्मेदारी एचओ लेके रखा है, दिल्ली में जितने रिक्रूटमेंट्स हो रहे हैं उसकी सारी जिम्मेदारी एचओ लेके रखा है। तो एचओ में जो भी ये डिपार्टमेंट बैठा है कॉमन, वो एक्चुअल में दिल्ली को एक सर्विस दे रहा है जिसको हम क्रॉस चार्ज कहते हैं। अब लॉ क्या कहता है कि एक एचओ जो कलकत्ता में लोकेटेड है वो एक इनवॉइस रेस करके दिल्ली के ऊपर चार्ज करे, तो इसमें दो क्वेश्चन आता है, एक किस वैल्यू पे चार्ज किया जाए और दूसरा कब चार्ज किया जाए। नॉर्मली जैसे जैसे ये फंक्शन दिया जाता है उस समय हम लोगों को इनवॉइस रेस करना चाहिए। अगर साल के अंत में हम टुगेदर एक रेस कर सकें तो वो भी हमको करना चाहिए। तो अभी 31 मार्च तक कोई भी हेड ऑफिस अपने पूरे इंडिया में ब्रांचेस को कोई भी सर्विसेज अगर ऐसा दिया है उसका वैल्यूएशन, उसका मूल्यांकन करके एक हेड ऑफिस को क्रॉस चार्ज इनवॉइस रेस करना चाहिए ताकि वो दिल्ली ब्रांच उसका क्रेडिट ले सके। अब वैल्यूएशन रूल्स बोलता है, वो बोलता है कि ट्रांजैक्शन अगर डिस्टिंक्ट पर्सन के बीच में हो और सामने वाला अगर क्रेडिट ले सके तो जो भी वैल्यू हम इनवॉइस में डालेंगे वही माननीय हो जाएगी एज वैल्यू बिटवीन द ट्रांजेक्शन बिटवीन टू पार्टीज। इम्पोर्टेंट बात यह है, मूल तत्व यह है कि अगर हम ये नहीं करें, अगर हम ये भूल जाएं साल भर बाद, दो साल बाद, अगर डिपार्टमेंट ऑडिट पे आता है तो वो अपने को एक डिमांड रेज करेगा कि आपने हेड ऑफिस ने जो कलकत्ता में बैठा है उसने दिल्ली को एक सर्विस प्रोवाइड की थी और आपने कोई इनवॉइस रेज नहीं किया तो आपको वो जीएसटी देनी होगी। उस समय नुकसान अपना क्या होगा कि हो सकता है दिल्ली को उस ब्रांच को उसका क्रेडिट नहीं मिले। तो हम ऐसा करें ही क्यों, हम आज ही से ये चीज ध्यान रखें कि जितने भी ऐसे ट्रांजेक्शन हैं वो हम क्रॉस चार्ज का आज ही एक इनवॉइस रेज करा दें, 31 मार्च में उसका अकाउंट्स में इफेक्ट ले लें और ब्रांच अपना सितंबर के अंदर अंदर उसका क्रेडिट ले लें। तो ये तो हुआ क्रॉस चार्ज, और हमने जीएसटी रिटर्न में भी उसका इफेक्ट दिखा दें, अप्रैल से सितंबर के जीएसटी के बीच में उसका इफेक्ट दिखा दें। अब काफी लोगों को संशय ये आता है कि हम तो ये आईएसडी के थ्रू भी कर सकते हैं क्रॉस चार्ज में, तो इनपुट सर्विस डिस्ट्रीब्यूटर और क्रॉस चार्ज के बीच का डिफरेंस सबसे पहले हम समझ लें। इनपुट सर्विस डिस्ट्रीब्यूटर वो होता है जो बाकी ब्रांच के बिहाफ में सर्विसेज रिसीव करता है और फिर उसको डिस्ट्रीब्यूट करता है। फॉर एग्जांपल, जैसे पूरी कंपनी का ऑडिट हुआ तो ऑडिट एचओ ऑर्गेनाइज करवाता है एक चार्टेड अकाउंटेंट से, सारे ब्रांच का एचओ का कंपनी का ऑडिट करा के अकाउंट्स कंसोलिडेट करा के ऑडिट करा के उसका फाइलिंग करा और चार्टेड अकाउंटेंट एचओ के ऊपर एक बिल रेज करता है। तो एचओ ने ये बिल रेज किया है ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ एवरी ब्रांच, तो वो क्या करेगा, वो उस इनवॉइस को लेकर आईएसडी इनवॉइस रेज करके वो क्रेडिट डिस्ट्रीब्यूट करेगा सारे ब्रांचेस को। क्रॉस चार्ट में क्या होता है, एचओ खुद ही सर्विसेज देता है ब्रांच, जैसे मार्केटिंग फंक्शन, एचआर फंक्शन, तो एचओ ने खुद एक सप्लाई दी है ब्रांच को, और आईएसडी का केस में एचओ ने सप्लाई रिसीव किया है और ब्रांच को डिस्ट्रीब्यूट किया। तो ये दो डिफरेंस हम समझें। मैं आपको ये भी बताना चाहूंगा कि क्रॉस चार्ज के केस में कुछ एक एडवांस रूलिंग्स आई है जिन्होंने इस क्रॉस चार्ज के अंडरस्टैंडिंग को मोहर लगाई है, खास करके कोलंबिया एशिया हॉस्पिटल्स प्राइवेट लिमिटेड के केस में एडवांस रूलिंग में, सैलरी के केस में ऑफ कॉमन मैनेजमेंट एम्प्लॉइज के ऊपर ये मोहर लगाई है कि हाँ क्रॉस चार्ज इनवॉइसिंग होना चाहिए। तो हम लिटिगेशन में क्यों जाएं, हम दोनों के अंतर को समझें कि क्रॉस चार्ज क्या है, आईएसडी क्या है। क्रॉस चार्ज के केस में एचओ इनवॉइस रेस करे सारे ब्रांचेस को, आईएसडी का केस में हर महीने जो जो भी इनपुट सर्विस का इनवॉइस उसने रेस किया है वो टर्नओवर के बेसिस पे हम डिस्ट्रीब्यूट करें। अब आईएसडी का केस में थोड़ा सा अपने और डिस्कस करते हैं। आईएसडी का केस में क्या हो सकता है, आईएसडी का केस में नियम ये है कि हम सारा इनवॉइस जो रिसीव करते हैं उसको हर मास, हर महीने, एवरी मंथ वी नीड टू डिस्ट्रीब्यूट इट अमंगस्ट ब्रांचेस। वो डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन कैसे करना है, सबसे पहले वी नीड टू आइडेंटिफाई व्हाट क्रेडिट पर्टेन्स टू स्पेसिफिक ब्रांच, देन वी डिस्ट्रीब्यूट इट टू दैट पर्टिकुलर ब्रांच। सेकेंड, कॉमन सर्विसेज नीड्स टू बी डिस्ट्रीब्यूटेड टू ऑल द ब्रांचेस बेस्ड ऑन टर्नओवर। थर्ड, द मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट थिंग, इवन द ineligible credits received by input service distributor needs to be distributed to the branches and the branches need to reverse that credit. So ISD का खाता हर समय जीरो रहता है, जो क्रेडिट उसने रिसीव किया वो उसको डिस्ट्रीब्यूट किया, एलिजिबल स्पेसिफिकली टू ब्रांच तो वो स्पेसिफिक ब्रांच को दिया, कॉमन है तो सारे ब्रांच को रेशियो के तौर पे दिया, इस तरीका से उसने डिस्ट्रीब्यूट किया। अब कॉमन मिस्टेक्स क्या होता है कि भाई हमने कुछ ब्रांचेस को गलत डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन कर दिया, ये एक मिस्टेक हो सकता है कि स्पेसिफिक जो था वो नहीं किया। जैसे एक एग्जांपल, एक एजुकेशनल इंस्टीट्यूशन टैक्सेबल और नॉन टैक्सेबल दोनों सर्विसेज दे रहा है, वोकेशनल ट्रेनिंग फॉर एग्जांपल, PMGKY DDU सर्विसेज गवर्नमेंट के जो स्किलिंग है वो एग्जेम्प्ट है और बाकी जो वोकेशनल ट्रेनिंग है वो टैक्सेबल। एक एडवर्टाइजमेंट उसने किया PMGKY का जिसका इनवॉइस हेड ऑफिस ने रिसीव किया, अब ये स्पेसिफिकली उसी ब्रांच का है जो DDU का वोकेशनल ट्रेनिंग दे रहा है, तो ये जो भी GST क्रेडिट लगा ये उसी ब्रांच को जाना चाहिए, ये सारा में डिस्ट्रीब्यूट नहीं होना चाहिए। इससे नुकसान क्या है, बिकॉज DDU exempt है उसको वो क्रेडिट मिलेगा नहीं, लेकिन अगर हेड ऑफिस सब ब्रांचेस को कर देता है तो जो ब्रांच टैक्सेबल है उसको भी एक क्रेडिट चला जाएगा और वो क्रेडिट ले लेगा, वो गलत हो जाएगा। तो इस केस में हमारे दो नुकसान है, एक कहीं हमारा अनिवार्य क्रेडिट छूट नहीं जाए, आईएसटी उसको डिस्ट्रीब्यूट करे, सेकंड कहीं गलत क्रेडिट नहीं चला जाए, गलत ब्रांच को नहीं चला जाए, क्योंकि बाद में अगर ऑडिट होगा तो वो ब्रांच जिसने गलत क्रेडिट लिया है वो क्रेडिट तो जाएगा ही, जिस ब्रांच के लिए बनता था उसको मिलेगा नहीं। तो ये एक और अनिवार्य बात है कि कहीं कोई गलत क्रेडिट नहीं चला जाए। तो इसमें सजेस्टिव ये है, इट इज एडवाइजरी कि वी मेक अ रिकंसिलिएशन ऑफ ऑल आईएसटी इनवॉइसेस, चेक ऑल द डिस्ट्रीब्यूशंस व्हिच आर बीइंग डन टू ब्रांचेस बिटवीन दिस डेट 31st मार्च टू 30th सितंबर, वी हैव इनफ टाइम टू डू दिस रिकंसिलिएशन एंड वी distribute the correct credit to all branches so that no branch faces any loss of credit in future. Dusra, ek aur mistake mein jo aap logon ko batana chahunga jo hum log face karte hain, maan lijiye ki ye auditor HO ek ISD credit bhi leke rakha hai aur normal supply ka GST bhi leke rakha hai. To jo ISD ka credit hai kahin aisa nahi ho ki vendor ne भूल से GSTN में रेस कर दिया इंस्टेड ऑफ ISD में, नॉर्मल GSTN में रेस कर दिया इंस्टेड ऑफ ISD में। तो ये इनवॉइस का चेकिंग भी बहुत जरूरी है कि ISD का इनवॉइस ISD में रेस हुआ है, नॉर्मल का इनवॉइस GSTN का नॉर्मल में रेस हुआ है। एग्जांपल देता हूँ कि भाई HO क्रॉस चार्ज के लिए एक सप्लाई का GSTN लेके रखा है और एक ISD का GSTN लेके रखा है, तो कहीं ऑडिटर ने सप्लाई वाले GSTN में बिल रेस कर दिया हो, ISD वाला में बिल रेस नहीं किया हो, ये मिस्टेक्स भी कॉमनली फाइंड की गई है। तो इसको भी हमको रिकनसाइल करना चाहिए कि करेक्ट GSTN में इनवॉइस रेज हुआ हो और वहां से करेक्ट डिस्ट्रीब्यूट हुआ। तो ये दो चीजें संग में अपने को देखने की दरकार है, वो है क्रॉस चार्ज और दूसरा है अपना ISD इनवॉइस। तीसरा ITC रिवर्सल्स, हमको ITC रिवर्सल कब करना पड़ता है, हमको ITC रिवर्सल करना पड़ता है एग्जेम्प्ट सप्लाईज के केस में, नॉन GST सप्लाईज के केस में, नॉन बिजनेस सप्लाईज के केस में, बाई चांस हमने भूल से इनएलिजिबल परचेजेस ले लिए उसके केस में हमको रिवर्सल करना पड़ता है। ड्यूरिंग द ईयर अगर हमने कोई कैपिटल गुड्स डिस्पोज किया है तो हमको ट्रांजेक्शन वैल्यू पे या ITC विच एवर इज हायर पे रिवर्सल करना पड़ता है। कॉमन इनपुट्स जो है जो टैक्सेबल और एग्जेम्प्ट में लगे हैं वो हमें रिवर्स करने पड़ते हैं, तो ये रिवर्सल हमारा प्रॉपर होना चाहिए। अब पूरे साल का अगर हम ये वर्किंग अभी कर लें बिटवीन अप्रैल टू सितंबर कि कितने हमारे एग्जेम्प्ट सप्लाईज हुए, कितने हमारे नॉन GST नॉन बिजनेस सप्लाईज हुए, उसके प्रोपोर्शन में हम ITC जितना एलिजिबल बनता है टैक्सेबल सप्लाईज के लिए उतना ही लें, ये एक बार वर्किंग वापस कर, हो सकता है महीना महीना एवरी मंथ वी माइट हैव डन दिस वर्किंग, बट इट इज ऑल्सो इम्पोर्टेंट दैट नाउ क्यूमुलेटिवली वी डू दिस वर्किंग फॉर द एंटायर ईयर and we find out which ITC pertains to exempt supplies, non-GST supplies, non-business supplies, and we reverse. So this working is very important. Why it is important? Because if in future department comes and does an audit and points out that you have availed wrong credit, then we have to reverse credit with a exorbitant interest amount of 18% to 24% as the case may be. So it is very important that we do this reversal right now. For example, let us take real estate companies. In a real estate company, if there is a real estate project in which there is 20% commercial and 80% residential, then we are eligible to take credit for 20% commercial portion and reverse in case of 80% portion. And I am talking in case of new project where we have adopted the rate of 1% or 5%. In this case, it is very important that we identify we have taken correct credit for commercial portion and reverse the credit in respect of residential. Because if by September तक कुछ भी mistake हो गया, कुछ रह गया, तो हमारा वो चला जाएगा और interest का liability with interest काफी बड़ा आएगा। तो ये एक ITC reversal जो है, वो भी हम बहुत अच्छे से देखें। Fourth, एक reconcile हम पूरे साल का करें वेबिल्स के साथ। देखिए वेबिल में क्या इश्यू क्या है, सबसे पहले मैं आपको बताऊं, इफ एनी गुड्स हैव बीन मूव्ड without a rebill, जहाँ पे rebill issue करना चाहिए, हमारी penalty है 10,000 rupees or an amount equivalent to tax whichever is higher. अब क्या हुआ कि पूरे साल में कोई कोई केस में हमको rebill issue करना है, कोई कोई rebill हमको issue नहीं करना. rebill हमको कहाँ issue नहीं करना? For example, हम 50,000 के नीचे का consignment बेच रहे हैं, हमें rebill issue नहीं. हम नॉन मोटराइज्ड व्हीकल हैंड ड्रिवन कार्ट से भेज रहे हैं, हमको वेबिल इशू नहीं करना. हो सकता है गुड्स हम ट्रांसपोर्टर के यहाँ भेज रहे हो तो हमको खाली पार्ट ए इशू करना. तो ऐसे काफी सारे विधान है, प्रावधान है वेबिल के लिए, जहाँ पे वेयर वी मे हैव टू इशू और वेयर वी मे नॉट हैव टू इशू. एग्जेम्प्टेड गुड्स की सप्लाई से हमें वेबिल इशू नहीं करना. एक हम रिकंसिलिएशन कर लें कि भाई टोटल टर्नओवर हमारा ये है जिसमें इतना वेबिल इशू हुआ है, इतना के लिए हमको नहीं करना था और इतना के लिए हमको करना था, ये एक रिकंसिलिएशन हम कर लें. बिकॉज ये अपने को एनुअल रिटर्न ऑडिट में भी ये चीजें हमको देनी है, हमको ये भी पता चलेगा कि कहीं हमारे से कोई गलती नहीं हो गई है, और हमारे पास एक रिकंसिलिएशन भी रहेगा कि फ्यूचर में इफ द डिपार्टमेंट विजिट्स योर ऑफिस सेइंग दैट वेबिल वैल्यू इज दिस मच, टर्नओवर वैल्यू इज दिस मच, प्लीज एक्सप्लेन द डिफरेंस, देन वी हैव दैट रिकंसिलिएशन रेडी. So, very important that we reconcile the rebill also. Fourth, हमारे पास job worker के पास हम माल भेजते हैं. Job worker का नियम ये है कि any goods which are sent to job worker, whether be inputs or capital goods, there is a time limit by which the goods must come back to us. Time limit क्या है? अगर हम कोई raw material भेजते हैं तो वो goods एक साल में वापस आना चाहिए. अगर हम कोई कैपिटल गुड्स भेजते हैं तो वो 3 साल में वापस आना चाहिए. अब 31 मार्च तक आप देख लें कि कोई जॉब वर्क में गुड्स भेजा गया है जो वापस नहीं आया 1 ईयर, वो कैसे पता चलेगा? अगर एक ही तरीके का गुड्स है तो आप विफो बेसिस अप्लाई कर सकते हैं. मैं सबसे रिक्वेस्ट करूंगा कि अपना वीडियो जरा म्यूट कर दे क्योंकि बैकग्राउंड से नॉइजेज आ रही है. तो मैं जॉब वर्क पे था, तो जॉब वर्क में अगर हम 1 ईयर में पड़ा हुआ है गुड्स तो वो हम इमीडिएट एक्शन ले. तो सबसे पहला जो स्टेप है वो ये करें कि हम जितने भी गुड्स भेजे हैं और गुड्स जो जॉब वर्कर से वापस आया है उसको फिफो बेसिस पे एडजस्ट करें. उसके बाद हम ये पता लगाएं कि ऐसा कोई इनपुट्स है जिसको 1 ईयर से ज्यादा हो गया है बुक्स में जो वापस नहीं आया, चाहे वो स्क्रैप हो, चाहे वो डिफेक्टिव गुड्स हो, चाहे वो नॉर्मल गुड्स हो, हम उसका एक लेखा जोखा रेडी करें. वी प्रिपेयर एन अकाउंट्स वेयर वी सी दैट दीज गुड्स हैव बीन लाइंग विद द जॉब वर्कर फॉर मोर देन 1 ईयर. नियम क्या है कि अगर जॉब वर्कर के पास 1 साल से ज्यादा गुड्स रॉ मटेरियल पड़ा है और वो वापस नहीं आया है तो जो आपने इनपुट टैक्स क्रेडिट लिया है उसको आप रिवर्स करें. अब रिवर्स तो हम कर देंगे मान लीजिए, और वो जॉब वर्कर से मान लीजिए 14 महीना में 16 महीना में वापस आया तो क्या हमको उसका क्रेडिट फिर मिल जाएगा? उसका प्रावधान नहीं, वो एक लिटिगेटेड एरिया. तो इट इज माय सजेशन कि वी आइडेंटिफाई ऑल दोस गुड्स व्हिच आर लाइंग विद जॉब वर्कर प्रीमाइसेस फॉर मोर देन 1 ईयर. अगर उसको 1 साल नहीं हुआ है तो आप वो गुड्स वापस मंगवा लें, और अगर 1 साल के ऊपर होने वाला है और गुड्स आप वापस नहीं मंगवा सकते हैं तो इमीडिएटली अपने ज्यूरिसडिक्शनल कमिश्नर को लिखें फॉर परमिशन टू एक्सटेंड द टाइमलाइन टू गेट द गुड्स बैक. दे हैव द पावर टू एक्सटेंड द टाइमलाइन टू गेट द गुड्स बैक ऑन रीजनेबल रैशनल कॉजेज, एंड इन दैट केस वी मे नॉट हैव टू रिवर्स द ITC. हाउएवर the most important thing that we have to take care is ki agar nahi aaya hai aur humne permission bhi nahi liya hai to hame reverse karna padega aur usko wapas credit lene ka pravdhan GST mein question mark hai wo litigated. Second, kafi baar aisa hota hai ki job worker ke premises se hum further job worker ko bhej dete hain ya job worker ke premises se hum direct customer ko bhej dete hain, uska bhi ek reconciliation we prepare and keep. So that we are clear with the supply chain, we send it to job worker, and from job worker premises the goods was sold to the customer within 1 year, and it would be sufficient compliance. So our accounts also has to be made in such a manner that all these reconciliations are known to us now, so that we can give the necessary effect in the books, in the GST returns, in the annual return and audits, and also take permission from the jurisdictional commissioner wherever required, so that he can extend the timelines. So again, this is important. My next point is related party transactions. Related party transactions में हमें tax देना है. अगर वो supply है, तो हमको tax देना है. Law बोलता है, related party के बीच में अगर सामने वाले को credit मिलेगा, तो कोई problem नहीं. अगर credit नहीं मिलेगा, तो valuation rules के हिसाब से valuation होना चाहिए. Transactions between related party, even without consideration, is supply as per schedule 1, read with rule 28 of GST rules. इसमें issue क्या है? देखिए, issue सबसे important ये है कि मान लीजिए आपने related party transaction के ऊपर tax नहीं दिया, आप भूल गए. बाद में department जब audit पे आएगा और वो बोलेगा कि आपका इसके ऊपर tax बनता है, तो एक तो आपको tax देना पड़ेगा, दूसरा valuation भी वही decide करेगा, तीसरा जो रेसिपिएंट रिलेटेड पार्टी है उसको क्रेडिट भी उस समय नहीं मिलेगा. तो हमारे जितने रिलेटेड पार्टी ट्रांजैक्शन है उसका हम लोग लेखा जोखा निकाले. मैं कुछ उदाहरण देता हूँ. फॉर एग्जाम्पल, हमने अपने ग्रुप कंपनी को स्पेस रेंट पे दिया जिसका हमने कोई चार्ज नहीं किया. मान लीजिए एक ही प्रीमाइसेस है जो एक जन के नाम पे है और वहां पे मल्टीपल ग्रुप कंपनीज ऑपरेट करती है, लेकिन हमने कोई रेंट चार्ज नहीं. दूसरा एक और एग्जाम्पल देता हूँ जो हमारे ग्रुप के क्लाइंट का, कि एक एक ज्वेलरी का ब्रांड है जो सात भाई यूज करते हैं, सात अलग अलग कंपनी, और ब्रांड एक ही, और वो ब्रांड इज शेयर्ड बाय ऑल सेवन ब्रदर्स हैविंग ऑल डिफरेंट कंपनीज. देन दैट पर्सन हु इज ओनिंग द ब्रांड, हु इज अलाउइंग द यूसेज ऑफ ब्रांड टू ऑल अदर सेवन कंपनीज, मस्ट चार्ज एन अमाउंट, बिकॉज इफ दे डू नॉट चार्ज, the valuation is left on to the department. The credit taking goes away because then the time limit to avail credit goes away, and you are in for a big shocker on the valuation. So very important that in all related party transactions, you identify from the books of accounts that which are transaction which are between related party, have we paid sufficient tax on that, have our related party taken credit of that. This has to be identified. Here, जितने सारे TDS और TCS है उनका आप रिकंसिलेशन करें. TDS और TCS कहाँ पे आता है? TDS आता है जब आप कोई गवर्नमेंट का ट्रांजेक्शन करते हैं. फॉर एग्जाम्पल, वन ऑफ द SSC इज अ सिविल कॉन्ट्रैक्टर जिसने गवर्नमेंट का कोई कॉन्ट्रैक्ट उठाया है, तो गवर्नमेंट जो है जब सिविल कॉन्ट्रैक्टर को पेमेंट देगा तो वो एक TDS काटेगा और सिविल कॉन्ट्रैक्टर के अकाउंट में जमा देगा, जिसका क्रेडिट सिविल कॉन्ट्रैक्टर अपना लाइबिलिटी पे करते वक्त ले सकते. TCS कब आता है? जितने भी ट्रांजैक्शंस आपके ई कॉमर्स ऑपरेटर के थ्रू होते हैं, ई कॉमर्स ऑपरेटर इज सपोज टू कलेक्ट सर्टेन टैक्स एट सोर्स फ्रॉम द पेमेंट दैट ही इज सपोज टू मेक टू यू, तो वो क्रेडिट भी आप ले सकते हैं आपके आउटपुट की लाइबिलिटी को डिस्पोज कर. तो एक हम रिकंसिलेशन कर लें कि भाई टोटल ट्रांजेक्शन्स ऐसे हमारे साल में कितने हुए हैं, उसके केस में गवर्नमेंट ने कितना TDS काटा है, ई कॉमर्स ऑपरेटर ने कितना TCS काटा है, कितना जमा दिया है, कितना हमारे अकाउंट में रिफ्लेक्ट कर रहा है, कितना नहीं रिफ्लेक्ट कर रहा है. अगर नहीं कर रहा है तो उसको हम फोन करें, बात करें, और वो TDS और TCS के क्लैरिफिकेशन को सितंबर के पहले पहले क्लियर करें, ताकि हमारा बुक्स, GST रिटर्न और एनुअल ऑडिट वगैरह सेम पेज पे. तो ये हमारे लिए बहुत इम्पोर्टेंट है. उसके बाद ईयर एंड कंप्लाइंसेज में आपको बताता हूँ, हमारे ISD के रिटर्न्स लगने चाहिए, हमारे जॉब वर्कर के जो गुड्स भेजे गए हैं ITC 04, वो जहाँ पे एप्लीकेबल है वहाँ पे होने चाहिए, ये हमें चेक कर लेना चाहिए. जो गुड्स हमने अप्रूवल पे भेजे हैं वो 180 डेज के अंदर वापस आने चाहिए. अगर नहीं आए हैं तो वो डीम्ड सप्लाई है, वो डीम्ड सप्लाई पे हमको टैक्स देना है, तो वो गुड्स ऑन अप्रूवल वाला जो है वो हम देते, वो ज्यादा जरूरी. उसके बाद एक हम अगर हमारा कोई रिफंड एप्लीकेशन बनता है तो तो उस रिफंड एप्लीकेशन का हम कंस्पेक्टस बना लें कि भाई कितने रिफंड एप्लीकेशन हमने फाइल किए, कितने रिजेक्ट हुए, कितने का रिक्रेडिट हमारे इलेक्ट्रॉनिक क्रेडिट लेजर में हो गया, कितना रिफंड रिसीव हो गया, ये सारा डिटेल्स का एक सबमिशन बना लें, क्योंकि ये हमें हमारे जीएसटी 9 और 9C भरने में यूज आने वाला है और इसका लेखा जोखा हमारे बुक्स से मैच करता है। हमें LUT जो रिन्यू करना है वो 30 जून तक क्लैरिफिकेशन आया है कि एक्सटेंडेड है, यदि 30 जून तक आप 2021 का LUT एक्सटेंड करके फाइल कर सकते हैं, जितने आप 1920 का LUT यूज करें तो 30 जून के बाद 30 जून तक हम अपना LUT 2021 का अप्लाई करें। फिर हम कुछ चीजों के पर गौर तलब करें, जैसे अगर हमारा पास्ट ईयर में या करंट में कोई नया गुड्स ऐड हुआ हो, कोई नया प्लेस ऑफ बिजनेस ऐड हुआ हो, तो वो हम अपना रजिस्ट्रेशन सूटेबली अमेंड कर लें, वो हम बहुत ध्यान रखें। उसके बाद अगर हमने कोई बिजनेस एसेट्स डिस्पोज ऑफ किया हो, जैसे कोई लैपटॉप बिक्री किया हो या कंप्यूटर बिक्री किया हो, या हमने अपना लैपटॉप एम्प्लॉय को दे दिया हो कि भाई तुम ले जाओ, तुम ही पर्सनल यूज कर लो, या डायरेक्टर को दे दिया, तो उसके ऊपर भी जीएसटी का कंसिडरेशन आता है। एक रिलेटेड पार्टी ट्रांजेक्शन, दूसरा डिस्पोजल ऑफ बिजनेस एसेट्स के ऊपर टैक्स देने की बात, तो ये भी हम देख लें कि कहीं कुछ ऐसा ट्रांजेक्शन हुआ जो हो सकता है हमारे सेल ऑफ टर्नओवर में नहीं आया हो, जो हमने विदाउट एनी कंसिडरेशन दिया हो लेकिन जिसके ऊपर हमारा टैक्स बनता हो। कोई स्क्रैप सेल है जिसके ऊपर हमने टैक्स नहीं दिया हो तो वो हम ध्यान दे लें कि भाई स्क्रैप सेल है, छोटा आइटम है, हमने फैक्ट्री से, हमने जॉब वर्कर के प्रीमाइसेस से कहीं पे डिस्पोज ऑफ किया हो तो उसके ऊपर टैक्स का हम देख लें। मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टेंट बात, कहीं पे अगर हम इम्प्लॉय को नोटिस पीरियड वेव कर रहे हैं तो वो भी एक सप्लाई के माध्यम से, सप्लाई के ऊपर टैक्स आ सकता है, तो वो हम देख लें कि कहीं इम्प्लॉय को हमने नोटिस वेवर दिया हो, वो हम देख लें। 180 डेज का प्रावधान है कि अगर कोई वेंडर को आपने 180 डेज में पेमेंट नहीं किया हो तो उसको आप जीएसटी रिवर्स करें, जब वापस पेमेंट कर दिया हो तो उसका क्रेडिट ले लें। तो ये भी बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट है कि हम देख लें कि कितना हमारा क्रेडिटर एजिंग में 180 डेज के ऊपर आ रहा है, हमने उसका क्रेडिट रिवर्स किया है कि नहीं, अगर हमने किया है और उसको वापस पेमेंट कर दिया है तो हमने उसका क्रेडिट वापस लिया है कि नहीं, कहीं पे इंटरेस्ट की लायबिलिटी है तो हम इंटरेस्ट हम दे रहे हैं कि नहीं। कहीं पे भी पूरे साल में हमने अगर कोई भी क्रेडिटर को डिले पेमेंट का इंटरेस्ट चार्ज किया हो कि भाई इंटरेस्ट ऑन डिले पेमेंट हमने चार्ज किया है और उसका जीएसटी हमने नहीं भुगतान किया हो तो वो हम कर दे रहे हैं, वो बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट है कि कहीं पे कोई डिलेड पेमेंट है, कोई कैंसिलेशन चार्जेस है जो हमने लिया हो वो हम ले लें। रिवर्स चार्ज के केस में हमारा कहीं पे भी अगर सेल्फ टैक्स इन्वॉइस नहीं बना है, कहीं पेमेंट वाउचर नहीं बना है तो वो हम बना लें और राइट इनवॉइस के बेसिस पे हम क्रेडिट लें, उसका भी हम ध्यान रखें। उसके बाद आता है डेबिट नोट क्रेडिट नोट। देखिए सबसे इंपॉर्टेंट बात अभी क्या है डेबिट नोट क्रेडिट नोट में, सबसे पहले मैं क्रेडिट नोट पे आता हूँ। डेबिट नोट क्रेडिट नोट कब इशू किया जाना चाहिए, सेल्स रिटर्न, परचेज रिटर्न, कोई डिस्काउंट हमने दिया हो, कोई हमसे भूल हुई हो, तो उस केस में हमें डेबिट नोट और क्रेडिट नोट इशू करने की आवश्यकता। अब हमने परचेज किया है और परचेज रिटर्न किया है तो हमको इशू करने की आवश्यकता है कि भाई हम उसको डेबिट नोट क्रेडिट नोट इशू करें। जहां पे हमारा क्रेडिट लेने का बात आता है उसका समय है कि भाई 30 सितंबर का रिटर्न के अंदर हम लगे। मैं हर समय ये अज्यूम कर रहा हूँ कि एनुअल रिटर्न हमारी सितंबर के रिटर्न के बाद लगेगी। नियम ये है कि दिस इफेक्ट्स आर टू बी गिवन बिफोर date of filing of September return or annual return, whichever is earlier. And in my argument, I am assuming that my annual return will be filed later than September return. So, September के return के अंदर हमारा जितना सारा debit note, credit note है, वो हम proper कर लें। अभी क्या है, सबसे important बात क्या है कि अभी प्रावधान है कि सारा debit note, credit note should be linked with the invoices. ये आया है recent budget प्रपोजल की हम लिंकिंग से डेबिट नोट को हटाएंगे, लेकिन वो प्रावधान अभी नोटिफिकेशन में आया नहीं। तो 1920 के लिए हमारा डेबिट नोट क्रेडिट नोट इनवॉइसेस से लिंक है कि नहीं, ये आप देख लीजिए। कहीं ऐसा नहीं हो कि भाई डेबिट नोट क्रेडिट नोट हमने इशू किया, उसका इफेक्ट हमने बुक्स ऑफ अकाउंट्स में भी लिया, जीएसटी रिटर्न में भी लिया, लेकिन वो लिंकिंग नहीं है, उसके वजह से डिपार्टमेंट हमारे को लिटिगेशन मिला। और इम्पोर्टेंट बात क्या है, कई बार मैंने देखा है कि वेंडर और डेटर और क्रेडिटर के बीच में आपस में क्रेडिट नोट डेबिट नोट का ट्रांजेक्शन हुआ है जहां पे टैक्स इम्प्लीकेशन उन्होंने नहीं डाला। मान लीजिए रास्ता में माल शॉर्टेज हो गया, एक क्रेडिट नोट इशू हुआ जिसके ऊपर टैक्स का इम्प्लीकेशन नहीं डाला गया, तो सप्लायर ने फुल वैल्यू के ऊपर टैक्स दिया, परचेजर ने फुल वैल्यू के ऊपर क्रेडिट लिया, लेकिन कोई डेबिट नोट क्रेडिट नोट का ट्रांजेक्शन नहीं। इसमें केस में क्या हुआ कि भाई बुक्स ऑफ अकाउंट में तो हमने डेबिट नोट क्रेडिट नोट का एडजस्टमेंट लिया लेकिन जीएसटी रिटर्न में नहीं लिया, तो उससे भी हमें रिकनसाइल करने की दरकार है। तो ये डेबिट नोट क्रेडिट नोट भी बहुत ही इम्पोर्टेंट हो जाता है। फिर सेकेंड है, हम एक बार देख लें ऐसा कि भाई जितने भी हमारे वेंडर लेजर्स है, हमारे ITC लेजर है, हमारा ई क्रेडिट लेजर है, ये तीनों का रिकनसिलेशन है। क्योंकि हम लोग महीना महीना जब करते हैं और ईयर एंड में करते हैं तो मिस्टेक्स जैसे देखी गई है, ऐसा भी मिस्टेक हुआ है कि मल्टी ब्रांच वाली कंपनी है जिसका सारा जीएसटी रिटर्न लगता है सेंट्रलाइज हेड ऑफिस, एक स्टेट का क्रेडिट दूसरा स्टेट में ले लिया गया, ये मिस्टेक्स हुई। आपने बुक्स ऑफ अकाउंट्स में इनवॉइस को करेक्ट रिकॉर्ड किया है लेकिन पार्टी ने जब अपना रिटर्न भरा है तो उसने इनकरेक्ट इनवॉइस नंबर डाल दिया है, इनकरेक्ट वैल्यू डाल दिया है, GSTN नंबर गलत डाल दिया। मतलब फॉर एग्जांपल पार्टी ने सप्लाई किया दिल्ली को जो कि एक रजिस्टर्ड यूनिट है लेकिन बिल रेज कर दिया इनएडवर्टेंटली HO को जो फिर भी GST रजिस्टर्ड है, तो ऐसी मिस्टेक्स भी हुई है। तो हम ऐसी मिस्टेक्स अगर ध्यान दे लें, आप भी रिकनसाइल कर लें कि भाई वेंडर में टोटल हमारा इनवॉइस कितना आया, कितना क्रेडिट मिला, हमारे ITC लेजर में जो बुक्स ऑफ अकाउंट्स हम मेंटेन करते हैं उसमें कितना क्रेडिट गया है, और हमारे इलेक्ट्रॉनिक क्रेडिट लेजर में कितना क्रेडिट गया है। तो ये हम कर ले अलोंग विद 2A, तो ये रिकंसिलिएशन बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट हो जाता है। 2A का रिकंसिलिएशन खास करके बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट है। क्यों इंपॉर्टेंट है? क्योंकि 1920 में दो डेट, एक अक्टूबर तक डेट है जो बोलता था कि भाई आपने जितना बुक्स में क्लेम किया वो क्रेडिट आप ले सकते हैं, जहां पे 2A में और बुक्स में मिसमैच है तो हम लोग ITC में क्लेम करें। अक्टूबर से आया कि भाई आप ITC में 2A में जितना दिख रहा है उससे प्लस 20% आप क्लेम कर सकते हैं। फिर चेंज होके इस 20% को 10% किया गया दिसंबर से, तो तीन तो हमारे ये डेट हो गए। दूसरा, 2A में वो भी क्रेडिट दिखेगा जो इनएलिजिबल है, जो हम नहीं ले सकते हैं। 2A में वो भी क्रेडिट दिखेगा जो आपके नाम का नहीं है बट पार्टी ने आपके नाम पे चला दिया। फॉर एग्जाम्पल आपके दिल्ली ब्रांच का होना चाहिए लेकिन आपके भूल से कलकत्ता ब्रांच के नाम पे चला दिया। इस तरीका से 2A में काफी सारी मिस्टेक्स मिलेगी जो आपको 2A, 3B और बुक्स को रिकनसाइल करना पड़ेगा, उसके ऊपर आपको इमीडिएट एक्शन लेना पड़ेगा। जैसे पार्टी ने अगर गलत भरा है तो उसको एक मेल करें कि आपने गलत भरा है, पार्टी ने अगर नहीं भरा है तो आप उसको एक मेल करें कि ये इनवॉइसेस आपका 2A में नहीं दिख रहा। अगर पार्टी ने राइट अमाउंट भरा है, इनवॉइस नंबर गलत भरा है, तो भी आप इंटीमेट करें। कुछ ऐसा क्रेडिट जो इनएलिजिबल क्रेडिट्स है, सिविल का क्रेडिट जैसे हो गया जो आपको नहीं मिलना चाहिए, वो अगर आपने ले लिया है तो आपको रिवर्स करना पड़ेगा। तो वो आप देखें कि हाँ 2A में दिख रहा है, हमने बुक्स ऑफ अकाउंट्स में नहीं लेना चाहिए था और हमको 3B में भी नहीं लेना चाहिए था, रिकनसाइल्ड है। अगर हमने भूल से ले लिया है तो उसको हम सितंबर के पहले पहले रिवर्स करें। ये भी मिस्टेक हमने देखा है कि पार्टीज ने एक्सपोर्ट किया है और उसको एग्जेम्प्टेड गुड्स मान के जीएसटी क्रेडिट रिवर्स कर दिया। एक्सपोर्ट ऑफ गुड्स का केस में आपको क्रेडिट मिलेगा एक्सपोर्ट, इसलिए कहीं ऐसा नहीं हो कि भूल से वो क्रेडिट भी आपने रिवर्स कर दिया। तो ये एक क्रेडिट वाला चीज जो है वो आप जरूर से जरूर रिकनसाइल करें, क्योंकि ये हमारे लिए एक बिजनेस के लिए कैश है। ऐसा भी हो सकता है कि कोई क्रेडिट 2A में दिख रहा है और हमने इनवॉइस रिकॉर्ड करना भूल, ऐसा हो सकता है कि 2A में दिख रहा है उस पार्टी के साथ हमारा कोई डिस्प्यूट चल रहा है, वो इनवॉइस हमने रिकॉर्ड नहीं किया हो। तो ये चीजें बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट है कि हम 2A का रिकनसिलिएशन एकदम अच्छा से करें। ऐसा भी होता है कि बैंक चार्जेस हम हर महीना लेते जाते हैं और बैंक जो है वो एक साथ हर महीना वो उसका क्रेडिट जमा नहीं करता, तो बैंक चार्जेस, क्रेडिट कार्ड, ये सब के ऊपर हम खास ध्यान दें कि भाई क्या मिस्टेक हो सकती है। 2A ही ऐसा एरिया है
जो हमारे लिए एक कैश का काम करता है, हमारे लिए क्रेडिट का काम करता है, जो हमारे को कॉस्ट बचाता है, तो इसके ऊपर रिकंसिलिएशन हम खास करके करें। फिर मैं ये भी सजेस्ट करूंगा आप लोगों को कि GSTR 1, GSTR 3 भी और बुक्स
वेट हाउ टू वर्क काफी बार ऐसा होता है जो देखा गया है कि 3B में हमने एक डेटा डाला, उसके बाद हमारा कॉन्ट्रैक्ट रीनिगोशिएट हुआ, इनवॉइस रीनिगोशिएट हुआ और सब्सिक्वेंट 3B में हमने उसको करेक्ट कर दिया, लेकिन GSTR 1 में हमारा ओरिजिनल इनवॉइस ही गया हुआ, उसमें कोई करेक्शन नहीं हुआ। तो सबसे इम्पोर्टेंट है कि हम टर्नओवर का रिको बनाए।
पहले कहाँ से शुरुआत करें, पहले बुक्स और 3B से शुरुआत करें कि बुक्स में हमारा क्या टर्नओवर
गया है और टर्नओवर में हमारा टैक्सेबल, नॉन टैक्सेबल, एग्जेम्प्ट, नॉन GST सप्लाईज सभी जाएगा, उसको हमने 3B में करेक्ट रिपोर्ट किया है कि नहीं, GSTR 1 में उसको हमने करेक्ट रिपोर्ट किया है कि नहीं, कहीं पे भी कोई एरर है तो वो उसको अभी हम अप्रैल से लेकर सितंबर के रिटर्न के अंदर अंदर उसको ठीक कर दें, ताकि नंबर वन हमारा बुक्स और हमारा रिटर्न एक सेम पेज पे आ सके, कहीं पे भी सामने वाले वेंडर को क्रेडिट नहीं मिल रहा है बिकॉज हमने मिस्टेक किया है वो आ जाए। प्लस इससे क्या होगा ना, GSTR 9 और 9C भरने में भी हमें बहुत सुविधा होगी, खास करके कैसा एरर्स है, जैसे प्लेस ऑफ सप्लाई का एरर्स मैंने देखा है कि होना चाहिए था CGST SGST, हमने कर दिया IGST, ये एरर्स भी हम अगर कहीं पे भी गौर तलब कर सके, निकाल सके, तो ये एरर्स भी हम निकाल के सितंबर तक कर दें, ताकि सामने वाले को क्रेडिट में कोई प्रॉब्लम नहीं हो, हमारा बुक्स एकदम सही हो जाए। ये रिकंसिलिएशन एक तो बनाना बहुत जरूरी है, इसमें कहीं पे भी कोई दो राय नहीं होनी चाहिए। दूसरा, हमारी कोई अगर SEZ सप्लाईज है उसमें हमने मिस्टेक किया, जैसे हम अपने क्लाइंट्स में यहाँ पे SEZ में मिस्टेक्स ऐसे देखें कि भाई SEZ ने ITC का क्रेडिट ले लिया है, SEZ जब गुड्स सप्लाई की है उन्होंने टैक्स भी दिया है, उस क्रेडिट को टैक्स में एडजस्ट करके आउटवर्ड टैक्स भर दिया है, तो ऐसा ऐसा SEZ का भी मिस्टेक्स हुआ है, तो SEZ के लॉ को भी ध्यान करते हुए उसको भी हम लोग करेक्ट कर लें। काफी बार हमने ये भी देखा है कि एक्सपोर्ट हुआ है लेकिन 3B में हमने उसको रेगुलर सप्लाईज में दिखा दिया है, तो वो भी हम करेक्ट कर लें, नहीं तो आपको रिफंड वगैरह मिलने में मुश्किलात हो जाएगी। एक मैं और एग्जांपल देता हूँ, जैसे ऑनलाइन हम लोग कोई माल बेचते हैं और ऑनलाइन वेबसाइट का SEO करने के लिए गूगल से हम लोग एडसेंस वगैरह एडवर्टीजमेंट वगैरह लेते हैं। अब हमने गूगल के साथ अग्रीमेंट किया HO का, और HO के साथ अग्रीमेंट है सिर्फ HO का ही GSTN दिया जो कि कोलकाता में बेस्ड, लेकिन ये एडसेंस का प्रयोग हमने फॉर एग्जांपल दिल्ली के लिए भी किया, गूगल को कहा कि आप दिल्ली में भी ये हमको करके दो। गूगल ने दिल्ली के लिए किया लेकिन गूगल के रिकॉर्ड्स में दिल्ली का कोई GSTN नहीं, उसने क्या किया, जो कोलकाता के लिए था वो कोलकाता के GSTN में इनवॉइस रेस करके हमको इनवॉइस भेज दिया। दिल्ली के लिए क्या किया उसने, बिकॉज दिल्ली का कोई GSTN उसके पास नहीं था, उसने टैक्स तो दिया लेकिन B2C में दिखा दिया। अब ऐसे मिस्टेक्स में क्या है कि ट्रांजेक्शन सब जेन्युइन है, सब सही है, लेकिन एक छोटी सी मिस्टेक कि उसके पास दिल्ली का GSTN नहीं है, उसने B2C में दिखा के टैक्स पेमेंट कर दिया और यहाँ पे दिल्ली ब्रांच को कोई क्रेडिट नहीं मिला और हमारे को क्रेडिट का नुकसान। अगर ये रिकंसिलिएशन हम अभी कर लें और गूगल को बताएं आपने ये मिस्टेक किया है, तो गूगल के पास अप्रैल से सितंबर तक तो टाइम है कि इसको B2C से हटा के डेबिट नोट क्रेडिट नोट के माध्यम से B2B में ले जाए और दिल्ली को क्रेडिट दिखाए। अगर ये सितंबर निकल गया तो फिर गूगल के लिए भी कुछ करने के लिए नहीं रहेगा और हमारी क्रेडिट्स भी चली जाएगी। हालांकि इसका रास्ता है लेकिन इसका रास्ता लिटिगेशन से भरा हुआ है, तो हम ये बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट समझें कि भाई हमारे रिकंसिलिएशन जो है वो टाइम पे हो जाए। अब मैं ये रिकंसिलिएशन क्यों कह रहा हूँ, रिकंसिलिएशन दो तीन चीज कारण से कह रहा हूँ। एक, हम जब बुक्स क्लोजिंग करें, अगर हम चार्टेड अकाउंटेंट हैं, हम हो सकता है GST की प्रैक्टिस करें नहीं करें, हम जीएसटी की और हम बुक्स की ऑडिट कर रहे हैं. जब हम बुक्स की ऑडिट कर रहे हैं तो एक स्टैट्यूटरी ऑडिटर के पास एक चेकलिस्ट होनी चाहिए कि भाई हम क्लाइंट का ये चेक कर रहे हैं, और अगर इसमें कहीं पे डिविएशन है, लॉ में डिविएशन है, तो या तो बुक्स में हम करेक्ट प्रोविजन लें या हम करेक्ट रिपोर्टिंग करें. तो एक चेकलिस्ट तो ये काम आएगी एक और स्टैट्यूटरी ऑडिटर. सेकेंड, ये चेकलिस्ट काम आएगी इंटरनल ऑडिटर को कि जो इंटरनल ऑडिट कर रहा है वो भी ये पॉइंट्स को देखे और मैनेजमेंट को हाईलाइट करे कि भाई ऐसी ऐसी चीजें हुई. थर्ड है रियल एस्टेट के केस में, फॉर एग्जांपल हमारी रिवर्सल्स है. हमारी रिवर्सल्स कैसे है कि भाई आपको 80% आइटम कम से कम रजिस्टर्ड पार्टी से खरीदना है, आप फुल रेजिडेंशियल प्रोजेक्ट हैं और आप 1% 5% पे टैक्स दे रहे हैं, आप कोई भी क्रेडिट लेने के सक्षम नहीं है क्योंकि आप 1% 5% में ऑपरेट कर रहे हैं. तो इसमें नियम यह है कि हमारा 80% जो है अनरजिस्टर्ड से खरीदना चाहिए और 20% रजिस्टर्ड से. इसमें नियम यह है कि सीमेंट तो कम से कम हमारे रजिस्टर्ड से आना चाहिए. अगर सीमेंट रजिस्टर्ड से नहीं आता है तो रिवर्स चार्ज में आपको 28% पे टैक्स देना. हमने अभी रिकंसिलिएशन करते वक्त ये गलतियां देखी है कि क्लाइंट ने रिवर्स चार्ज में टैक्स को दिया अनरजिस्टर्ड सीमेंट से खरीदने के लिए, लेकिन 18% दे दिया, 28% नहीं दिया. अब वो बाद में इतना बड़ा इंटरेस्ट के साथ लाइबिलिटी खड़ा होता है. तो अगर हम ये अभी कर दें तो हम ये इंटरेस्ट से बच सकें. तो ये चीजें भी बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट है कि भाई हम एक चेकलिस्ट बना लें, उस चेकलिस्ट के अनुसार ऐसी ऐसी चेकलिस्ट में स्टैट्यूटरी ऑडिटर, इंटरनल ऑडिटर, जीएसटी ऑडिटर, जीएसटी कंसल्टेंट्स उस चेकलिस्ट को टिक करता जाए कि हाँ ये क्लाइंट ने किया है, ये क्लाइंट ने रिकंसिलिएशन किया है, और इस रिकंसिलिएशन को हम चेक करते हुए हम अपने आप को सेटिस्फाई करें कि बुक्स 3B 1 2A ये सही रास्ते में गया. रिवर्स चार्ज मैकेनिज्म में भी हम देख लें कि भाई रिवर्स चार्ज करेक्ट दिया गया है. जहाँ पे प्रोजेक्ट कंप्लीट हो रहा है, सीसी आ गई है, तो सीसी के बाद अगर गुड्स नहीं बिका है तो हमको आईटीसी रिवर्सल करना है. अगर कोई ट्रांसफर ऑफ डेवलपमेंट राइट्स है तो सीसी के बाद हमको ट्रांसफर ऑफ डेवलपमेंट के राइट्स के ऊपर भी रिवर्स चार्ज करना है. इस साल कार हायर चार्जेस को रिवर्स चार्ज मैकेनिज्म में ऐड किया गया था, तो उसके ऊपर भी हम ये करें कि भाई कार हायर चार्जेस के ऊपर भी हमने रिवर्स चार्ज दिया है. कोई इंपोर्ट ऑफ सर्विसेज है फ्रॉम रिलेटेड पार्टी है, विदाउट कंसिडरेशन है, तो उसके ऊपर भी हमें रिवर्स चार्ज देना बनता है, वो भी हम दें. कोई कमीशन एजेंट है तो करेक्ट प्लेस ऑफ सप्लाई समझ के हमको रिवर्स चार्ज जहां देना है वहां हम दें. क्यों रिवर्स चार्ज इंपॉर्टेंट है सितंबर के पहले कि भाई रिवर्स चार्ज देके हम क्रेडिट ले लें. सितंबर के बाद आपका क्रेडिट डिस्प्यूटेड हो जाए. हालांकि एक इंटरप्रिटेशन ये है कि रिवर्स चार्ज के ऊपर जब आप देते हैं टैक्स तब क्रेडिट बनता है, लेकिन ये लिटिगेटेड हो जाएगा, ये डिस्प्यूटेड हो जाएगा. तो सारा रिवर्स चार्ज का रिकंसिलिएशन भी हम करके एक ऐसा कर लें कि करेक्ट रिवर्स चार्ज जो देना है देके हम उसका क्रेडिट ले लें. तो हमारे पर कॉस्ट के ऊपर कोई नुकसान नहीं है, बल्कि अपितु वी सेव ऑन इंटरेस्ट कॉस्ट. इट इज आवर इंटरेस्ट कॉस्ट डज नॉट बिकम अ ह्यूज बर्डन. सो दीज आर दी सर्टेन पॉइंट्स विच आर वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट दैट वी नीड टू टेक केयर ऑफ. वॉट आई हैव डन इज आई हैव प्रिपेयर्ड अ नोट कवरिंग दीज पॉइंट्स वॉट एवर आई हैव डिस्कस्ड एंड सम मोर इन डिटेल कि भाई वॉट एवर आई कुड नॉट, बिकॉज समय की नियम को देखते हुए, समय के एक सीमा को देखते हुए जिसको मेरे को दिया गया है उसमें मैंने जितना पॉइंट्स इंपॉर्टेंट था प्रायोरिटी बेसिस पे आपके साथ डिस्कस किया. मैंने एक नोट रेडी किया जिसके ऊपर मैंने वो पॉइंट्स भी डाला है जो मैं आपके साथ डिस्कस नहीं कर सका हूँ, और मैंने वो पॉइंट्स को और डिटेल में डिस्कस किया है जो मैंने आपके साथ डिस्कस किया है. सो विद द परमिशन ऑफ डीएस अग्रवाला जी, आई विल शेयर दैट नोट्स ऑल्सो विथ यू एंड I will be there to take your questions on this. The only request is please stay safe, stay healthy under this corona, stay at home. Our next speaker, Ankit ji, will take up these issues also, which are to be reflected in annual return and audit. So it will be a very complimentary effort. Thank you, DTPA, for giving me this time to deliberate on this topic. Over to DS Agarwala ji.
Thank you, Rohit, for a very wonderful presentation, I must say. अपने बोलते ना गागर में सागर, तो वो कहावत अपने चरितार्थ कर दी आज. in 45 minutes, you have covered almost entire gamut of GST law. I was just wondering, आपको इतना कुछ याद कैसे रहता है? छोटी-छोटी बातें कहाँ-कहाँ से उठा के आप लेके आ रहे थे, चाहे ऑडिटी और क्रॉस चेक का मैटर हो, जो भी आप डिस्कस कर रहे थे, it was simply wonderful. मैं जस्ट एकदम पिंट ऑफ सामने बैठा हुआ सुन रहा था आपको, एंड इट वाज सिंपली ग्रेट. आप अपना जो शेयरिंग के लिए आप जो बोल रहे हो दैट यू डू विल हम सब जो पार्टिसिपेंट्स हैं उनको शेयर कर लेंगे जो आपका प्रेजेंटेशन या जो भी आप शेयर करना चाहते हो. एंड विद दिस नाउ कुछ क्वेश्चंस भी आपके लिए हैं, यू कैन गो थ्रू दोज क्वेश्चंस. And after Ankit finishes his deliberation, we'll take up these questions one by one.
Sure.
Thanks, Rohit. And now I request Ankit to start his deliberation. Ankit, please.
Thank you, dear sir. And thank you, Rohit ji, for making the session very lively, because my work, half of the work of 2A, you have already done. So things becomes easy for my at my end also. So now coming to my topic, the topic which has been allocated is about the issues that will probably come up during this annual return and annual audit 9A and 9C for the financial year 18-19 that has already begun. The due date, one due date has already been extended till 30th June. Maybe we have to wait for another extension soon because of today's announcement of the Honorable Prime Minister. So every time when we start with this reconciliation, when we at our office started with some reconciliation of our clients, we face certain issues. So this topic, we are not going to discuss what is annual return, what are the legal provisions, how to fill annual return. No, the only thing that we are going to discuss today would be regarding the key points wherein how to show the changes, issues of 17-18 in 18-19 annual return. What kind of issues that is coming up in audit during reconciliation of 18-19, so that we are aware, and maybe we can put up a note before the CBC for this, so that we can have more clarity on the subject. Correct. So I am sharing annual return format, a filed annual return format for the for all the viewers per se, so that we can just have a glance through this particular annual return. So when I speak of GSTR 9, when I speak of GSTR 9 annual return, we know table part 2, table 4 and table 5, the figures here are being auto populated from the GSTR 1 of the SSC, which the SSC has filed for the financial year 18-19. So maybe there is a reconciliation. We do a reconciliation ki in GSTR 1 for all the 12 months, the SSC has filed, say, a turnover of 1 lakh rupees. And for the GSTR 3B also, there is a turnover of 1 lakh rupees disclosed. But during the audit, we come to know out of this 1 lakh rupees of turnover which has been disclosed, 10,000 rupees turnover pertains to 17-18. The 10,000 rupees turnover pertains to 17-18. Which belongs to the financial year 17-18, and in fact, the SSC had shown that also in table number 10 of GST 9 for the financial year 17-18. So, if I can go to table 10 of GST 9, table part 5, serial number 10, it says supplies tax declared through amendments. So, I again take you back to the example. Wherein, say, my 17-18, I had missed certain supplies to disclose till the March GSTR 1 and 3B. And law allows me to disclose certain of my supplies in the next financial year up to September. I had shown, 10,000 rupees supplies of financial year 17-18 in GSTR 1 and 3B of financial year 18-19. So when I have filed the GSTR 9 of 17-18, I had to take recourse to this table number 10, which is on your screen, which says supplies tax declared through amendment. Amendment, please note, it includes any new addition also. So, in my 17-18 financial year GST 9, I had shown a taxable value of 10,000 and say a tax amount of 1,800 rupees in IGST head also. Now, when I come to table number 4 of the current financial year GST Annual of 18-19, I will see that particular invoice, if it was a B2B invoice for example, is also being auto-populated in table number 4B of the current GST Annual. But your total reconciliations of 1 and 3B will match. There will not be an issue when you try to make a reconciliation between 1 and 3B. There will not be any issue. It will be matching because both you have paid the taxes through 1, through 3B, and you have disclosed the supply in GSTR 1. But it was in relation to 17-18. So, first very important aspect which comes up here is, if any such amendments that we have shown or any new invoices for 17-18, if it was disclosed in GSTR 1 of 18-19, because the time limit was extended till March for the financial year 18-19, for the financial 17-18 to be disclosed till March of 18-19, then you have to manually go and deduct the values of such supplies from table number 4A, B, C up to 4F if it is being shown. Correct? So this is the first very important point. We need to be very sure, because if we have shown any supplies into for 17-18 in 18-19, the portal as of now is not giving you any separate column to show it separately, or the auto drafted details in GST 9 is also not coming after deducting those details as of what some annual returns which I have seen for the time being. Maybe in times to come, if these clarifications goes to CVC, they may do something with the GSTN, of course. So first, a very important aspect in GST 9 would be this, correct? Similarly, for exempted supplies also, if anything you have shown in GSTR 1 of 18-19 which pertains to 17-18, which is auto-populating in table number 5 also, those things has to be manually deleted. The portal as of now is giving the same figures added thereon. Now we come to part 3, which is relating to ITC. As Rohit ji mentioned, that ITC can be availed for the financial year 18-19 up to September 19, CV of September 19. So, similar was the provision for 17-18. So, in 17-18, what happened, because of the various extensions given by the government in the first year of GST, many SSCs had availed the input tax credit for financial year 17-18 in the GSTR 3B of 18-19. Now, there are two aspects here which we need to understand. First would be whether those credits had been accounted for in the books of accounts of 17-18, or whether those credits had not been accounted in 17-18, it was accounted in the books of account also in 18-19. Because the total picture will depend upon how have you accounted for the same. So coming to first situation, suppose wherein in the books you had accounted for in 17-18, but you had availed the ITC of that particular invoice in the GSTR 3B of the next financial year. Then again, if I take you to the GSTR 9, if we again go to GSTR 9, table number 12 and 13, table number 13, it says ITC availed for the previous financial year. If you can see the heading also, for financial year 17-18, particulars of the transaction for 17-18 as declared in returns between April 18 till March 19, because it was extended for 17-18 till March 19. So if we had accounted for in our books of accounts in 17-18, correct? But the ITC was availed by us in 18-19 3B, then of course we would have showed this amount in table number 13 of GSTR 9 of 17-18. Now I come to the main point, which is table number 6 of the current financial year GSTR 9 when I try to file. 6A gives you the auto-populated figure which is coming from table 4A of GSTR 3B, which is the sum total of the total ITC availed by the SSC in all the GSTR 3B files for the financial year 18-19. As all of us know, that GSTR 3B does not contain invoice level detail. It only contains the sum total of the total input that you are taking, maybe into various heads like import, reverse charge, all other ITC, ISD credits, others, and import of goods and services like that. So what has happened, that you have availed 17-18 credits in 18-19, which was booked in 17-18. when you are going to file the GST 9 of 18-19, the auto-populated figure in table 6A would include the credits which pertains to financial year 17-18 and which you had very well disclosed under table number 13 of the GST 9 of 17-18. But again, there has been no change in the portal as of now to differentiate, and I believe for this particular part, their portal cannot differentiate on its own because there is no invoice level detail available with the portal as to which credits the SSE has availed for which the invoices were dated 17-18 and for which the invoices were dated 18-19, correct? So there is no option for the portal to give that. Now, where does the problem lies? The problem lies when you give the breakup of these auto-populated details in the current financial year. For this breakup, you would go to your books of accounts. You will see which is my input, which is my capital good, which is my input services, how much credit is my reverse charge credit. And when you arrive at the sum total in column number 6I, subtotal, I presume there will be a good chance of a difference between the auto-populated figures which has come up in GST 9 for ITC and which the breakup you are trying to give, seeing your books of accounts. Why? Because your books of accounts for 18-19 will not contain the invoice level details of such credits of 17-18 which you have availed in 18-19. So first probable difference would be in column number 6J, which department has not yet come up with any annual return clarifications for the time being. Correct? But as a layman SSE, what I would do, I would, to the best of my knowledge, I would try to put in those figures also into input services capital goods and disclose it in this particular table so that the difference in 6J in my annual return of current financial year becomes zero. I have to do that because the portal is asking me for the breakup of the same into input services and capital goods, which I have not given earlier. Correct? So I, for all practical purpose, let us assume we'll give this breakup here. Next, CRAN credit. If you see the auto-drafted annual returns, in some of the annual returns, I saw the CRAN credit is again being populated in the GST 9. So again, you have to manually go and amend the same if it is appearing. Maybe now they have done some changes, but during the starting, when the return was started a month back, I saw many SSEs where the CRAN credit was again being auto-populated. But yes, you have to go and delete it manually. Otherwise, it would be creating a big difference between your 9 and 9C and books of accounts. Correct? So for ITC, which was availed in 17-18, which was booked in 17-18, but you had taken in 3B of 18-19, first issue lies here. Second, if we take this example, wherein the invoice of the vendor was dated 17-18. Suppose I have raised an invoice which was dated 17-18, but my client or my SSE had not accounted for the same in the books of accounts in 17-18. That means my invoice date is, say, 20th of March 2018. But since his books of accounts was closed and he received my invoice only on 20th April 2018, he accounted the invoice in the month of April 2018 and accordingly followed all the compliances. So my invoice date would be 17-18. I would have paid the tax in 17-18, but my SSE had availed the credit by booking the same in the books of accounts in 18-19. So in such case, whether table number 13, which we just saw for 17-18, whether we have disclosed this amount here or not, again, there is a big problem here because many SSEs, which I have discussed or over various forums that we have discussed this, many people say in this table, we have disclosed the such amounts wherein the invoice was dated 17-18. We have not checked whether we have taken in the books of accounts in 17-18 or not. But if the invoice was dated 17-18 and we have availed the credit in 18-19, we have disclosed the figure in table 13. So how far it would be correct, time should tell when the department comes for scrutiny or assessment, things like that. But nevertheless, if you can substantiate that you have availed the credit once, there would not be any issue, I believe, because these are just merely disclosure points that we are discussing. So coming back to my point, wherein I had not accounted for that in my books of accounts also, but my invoice was dated 17-18. And say if I have also disclosed that in this table number 13 or if I am not disclosing table number 13, my credits for the current financial year would be auto-populated in 6A. And since in my books of accounts, it has also been accounted for in the current financial year, I would be easily able to give this breakup of the same into input, input services and capital goods. And thereby, there will not be any issue for the, there will not be any issue of any difference arising of the same in the particular table number 6J. Correct? Plan credit we have discussed. Now, we come to something very important for table 8. What are the issues coming in table 8? So table 8, as everybody of us knows, is a comparison between 2A. As Rohit ji rightly pointed, 2A reconciliations have become important lately with the introduction of 36.4. But I would again still believe, it is my own view, I have my own views on this particular topic, is that 2A is still just an auto-populated data, and the press release of the CVEC, the press release of the CVEC dated 18th October 2018 still holds very good importance in my view, because that particular press release clearly mentioned in para 3 that 2A is an auto-populated data only. Denial of credit based on 2A cannot be done. Yes, now after that, when the law has been amended by 36.4, then things may be different, subject to, again, scrutiny of the department, scrutiny of the departments and this going into litigation into higher forums, that time will tell. But as of now, when we speak of this 2A, we have to do a reconciliation. Now, you see this annual return on your screens in this 2A is coming zero. So this was a problem when the annual return was just started. Many SSCs had filed the annual return at that point of time. The 2A was not there. We had read grievances that there's no auto-populated figure coming in 2A. But now that has been sorted by the portal. Now 2A figures are being auto-populated. Now, what is coming in this 2A figure? This 2A figure, ITC as per 2A, if you again recollect what happened in 17-18, there was an advisory released by GSTN which stated the 2A figure which is coming in GSTR 9 may not match with the 2A figure that you have downloaded from the offline tool facility available on the portal, because this is being updated on a regular basis and there is no cutoff date for this. Cutoff date, if when I say cutoff date, what do I mean? Say I have to file a GSTR 1 of July 17 today. I am a registered SSC. I had my GST number from July 17. But somehow I have not filed my GSTR 1 July 17. So today also I can go log into the portal, file my July 17 GSTR 1 and show invoices as B2B invoices, which goes to my customer. So when it goes to my customer's 2A, whether it goes in the current month's 2A, because I am filing July 17 GSTR 1, so whether it will go in July 17 GSTR 2A of my customer or whether it will go today. Of course, it should ideally go in July 17 GST R1, which the SSC may not, which my customer may not be looking at this moment of time anyhow. Second is, say, during my reconciliations with my customer, one of my customer told me, sir, you have missed one invoice of 18-19, which is not coming in the my customer's 2A. So I told, okay, sir, I will show it. I checked my accounts and I saw, yes, I have missed one invoice. So what I did in 19-20, I added that invoice of my customer, say in the September 2019 GST R1, and I paid the taxes also in September 2019 GST R3B, but the invoice was dated 18-19. So in this example, what I am doing, I am showing an invoice which is dated 18-19 in a GST R1 of 19-20. So whether it would go in the GST R2A of my customer of the date of the month in of which my invoice is dated, or it will go in the GST 2A of my customer for September 19, showing the invoice as dated of 18-19. Portal has its own restrictions. Sometimes portal says no, we will show it in the original GST 2A. Sometimes portal shows no, we will give you in the current month only, showing the invoice date as the particular month. Invoice date would be relating to the month in which it is shown. Practically, what we have seen is that, yes, if I am showing an invoice of previous year in the current year 1, it is coming in my GST 2A of the current year, where the invoice date is being shown as the
earlier month as per the invoice of the vendor. So when I see 2A now in table 8A, this 2A figure, which what the portal is giving, we had tried to reconcile for some of the SSEs, wherein we had taken the auto-drafted 2A figures as per GST 9 and again downloaded the 2A as on the date from the GST in portal. Again, there was a difference. So the source of this figure of 8A is still not known. So how do we do this reconciliation becomes very important. What I would share with you what my analogy goes for this. So basically, what does annual return in GST 9, what figures we have to give here? Government wants to know that, okay, whatever credit you have availed in this financial year, whether all your vendors has filed their GST 1 and paid their taxes. See, payment of taxes, again, cannot be confirmed by filing of GST 1. Everybody of us knows it here. But yes, government says we can catch hold of those persons through their GST 1. And if they have not filed 3B, there can be an action taken against them if they have disclosed their current liability in GST 1. So how do I do it? In fact, I take reference to a press release of CBEC released last year in June, wherein they stated that this table 8A, you can give it in particular in a separate PDF, create an Excel and PDF of it and attach it separately if you cannot fill in the figures here. So what I will do, I will see what is my 2A as per my GST portal. I will save a copy of the same and I will jot down the total figure of C and SI. Table 3 and 5 means B2B invoices and B2B amendments there, any amendments thereof. Correct. So I will jot down my figures. Now, in this 2A which I have downloaded for 18-19 each month, I am seeing in fact that there are many figures, many invoices for which the invoice is dated 17-18. Because 17-18, there was not so much importance given to 2A, correct? In the financial year 17-18, the 2A was not given so much importance. There was press release, there were judgments. So everybody was like, fine, we will take the credit as per our registers. And yes, we will push our vendors to show the same in GST R1, correct? So what had happened, when I take this 2A from the portal today, I see many invoices of 17-18 are coming in my 2A of 18-19, fine. So what I do, I create one more column. I first write total ITC as per 2A as on this date, the cutoff date, IC and S. Then I write in the next row, ITC pertaining to invoices dated 17-18 coming in 2A of 18-19. So I deduct that value from my particular total figures of 2A. And I arrive at a figure now, which is my cumulative figure of the invoices dated 18-19 and shown by my vendor also in the GST 1 of 18-19. That is the first step that I do in the reconciliation. Now, I compare this amount in table 8B when you see, they are comparing this amount with 6B and 6H. What is 6B? 6B is your total normal credit. 6B is the total ITC which has come up in case of forward charge. And 6H is any other ITC if you have reclaimed, if you have claimed, maybe cases of 180 days payment and reclaiming and things like that. Correct. So now when I try to compare this 8A and 8B, remember after 8A, I have inserted one more line, Suomoto, say 8A1. And I arrive at a figure of 8A after deducting the total 2A minus 17-18 invoices. I now compare this with my total ITC for the financial year 18-19 of which I have availed or invoices dated 18-19 also only. Because if I have availed certain credits of 17-18 in 18-19, whether it is coming in my table 6B, first one we need to check. And if we need to prepare two separate Excels showing 17-18 invoices availed by me in 18-19 3B and 18-19 invoices availed by me in 19-20 3B. Correct? Based on this, I will come to a difference of figure wherein I will see what is the status of my 2A when I see only invoices of 18-19. And whether 17-18 credits which are now coming in my 2A I will need to check whether I had availed this already in my 17, 18 or not. Because if I try to give figures here, if I try to give figures here in 8E and 8F, if whether my credit is available but it is ineligible, then things may be different because maybe I have availed the credit. But if I show it as ineligible here, when the department comes for assessment, it may take a view that you are only telling in your annual return that it is ineligible, but you have already taken the credit in 17-18. Which one is true? You have to tell me. So this reconciliation, please be very sure while you prepare this table number eight reconciliation. You have to keep in mind that 17-18 invoices which have come in 2A of 18-19 has to be first segregated. And then a reconciliation between 18-19 2A vis-a-vis 18-19 books of accounts has to be accordingly taken care of. Now, when you see table number 8C, what is 8C? 8C has also a very important is a part, which is similar to table number 13, which we have already taken. 8C says, it does not speak about books of accounts. 8C is that point which says, okay, if you have any in your 2A, if there is any invoices which is dated 18-19, it is coming in your 2A of 18-19, but you have availed the credit of the same in the financial year 19-20, say month-end purchases. Say one of my vendors had supplied me goods on 28th of March, but I received up to 28th March 2019, I received the goods on 4th April 19. So for me, the credit eligibility comes only on 4th March 19, not on 4th April 19, not on 28th March. So what will happen? That will come in my 2A, which will be coming in my 8A table, but it will not be coming in my 6B. So there will be a difference, which is not an ineligible credit also. So there in table 8C, you have to write the figure that, okay, this invoice, which was dated 18-19, I have availed the credit of the same in the financial year 19-20. Here, please note, there's a difference is that 8C does not speak about your books of accounts. 8C only tells you if an invoice dated 18-19 is coming in 2A, let me know whether you have availed the credit in next financial year. If you have availed the credit in next financial year, maybe you have booked in the same financial year, but somehow you have missed it. So when you are doing your year-end reconciliation, you see your books of account GL of input tax credit is showing a value of 10,000, but your GSTR 3B is showing a value of 9,000 only for the entire financial year. Then you come to know, okay, this 1,000 rupees is an excess in my books of accounts, which I missed to take in 3B, which I will be willing to take in my subsequent one 3B. So that amount figure, which would be coming in table number 8C, which is very important when we do this reconciliation of table number 8. Table number 8, government has given a relaxation by rules also that you may not furnish the details here. If you are facing problem, you can make a separate PDF of it and upload it separately. If you are filing 9C, then you can upload in any other document with 9C. Persons who do not have 9C, maybe you can prepare it at your own end and courier and speed it to your jurisdictional commissioner so that nothing is left vague when the actual assessment happens. Correct. Now, one more problem which I just missed was in table 6E, import of goods. Now there was a press release or advisory by the department, 6E, table number 6E, if I say, which was import of goods. The issue was the advisory which was stated in the June 6, 2019. It stated that whatever is your total import of goods for a financial year, you have to disclose it here. Maybe you have paid the, you have claimed the credit subsequently. Say I had imported goods under my bill of entry in financial year 18-19, the total value of IGST was 10 lakh rupees. But somehow I have availed the credit of not 1 lakh rupees. I have availed the credit in 18-19 only 7 lakh rupees. Two bill of entry I have missed, but the law says, the press release or the clarification says, you have to show the entire amount of import of goods in this particular table of 6E, whether you have availed the credit or not. So now lies my another problem. The problem, what is the problem? Say, in my books of accounts, I had a credit of 7 lakh rupees. 3 lakh rupees I had availed in the subsequent financial year after the financial year ended. But in my GST 9, I am showing total import of goods as 10 lakh rupees because of the government's direction on the same. So in my subsequent year GST 9, when I try to show the import of goods figure, whether I will mention 3 lakh or not, would only depend on what action you had taken in the previous year. So many people in the previous year, 17-18 financial year, had not shown the total import of goods. They will show it, the balance here. And if you have followed the press release and shown the total import of goods there, so in the current month also, if you show that particular 3 lakh in 18-19 GST 9, there will be a difference to that extent. And that for that difference, you have to give a comment in GST 9C, giving the reference to the 6 June press release of the department, telling us to show the total amount of imports here. Similar, that particular figure will again auto-populate in table 8G of the annual return, correct? Now, I come to part 4, table 9, which is again creating big problems of reconciliation. So, as we all know, we had paid 17-18 taxes through 3B of 18-19 till March. It was allowed by the government. Now, this particular table 9, part 4, the paid through cash and paid through ITC figures, which is auto-populating, it is freezed. You cannot touch these figures for the tax amounts, correct? But the tax payable figure is coming from the table number 4 above, including RCM liability. Now, what I have told you, I told you, sir, if you have disclosed certain tax liability of 17-18 in 18-19, you manually edit table number 4 and delete the particular amount there. Because in GST 9 of 18-19, you have to give reference to only 18-19 supplies, not 17-18. That has already been accounted for in 17-18. As soon as you edit the particular table number 4 and reduce your tax liability therein, the tax payable in the table number 9ABC and tax paid through cash or ITC in table number 9ABC, there will be a difference. Difference would be your tax payable would be less and tax paid would be more. Say there was a value of 1 lakh rupees which was for pertaining to 17-18 which you have deleted from table number 4. So in IGST head, suppose, so in 9A, IGST head will show 1 lakh rupees tax payable less. But when you calculate the paid through cash and paid through ITC, it will be showing 1 lakh more. So this reconciliation, again, part 4, table number 9 would be important when you go to 9C. And when you report, when you go to 9C, you have to report this particular thing that that the difference which is coming in table number 9 is an account of 17-18 supplies accounted for in GST 3B of 18-19 and tax paid through 3B of 18-19. But I cannot disclose it here because I have already disclosed that in table number 10 and 11 of GST 9 of 17-18. So particular comments in part B of your annual audit 9C has to be inserted. There may be reasons. Another one different reason in this table could be, say you had availed some ineligible credit in 18-19. And when you came to know in the month of March, you wanted to reverse it. So while reversing the amount in the month of March, there was no outward supply in your case. Or your outward supply tax liability was less than your total ITC, which was supposed to be reversed. So your GST 3B allowed you to take write negative ITC figure. Means your ITC reversal was more than your ITC availed in the month of March. Then how does GST 3B work? GST 3B adds that particular amount as good as your output liability and you discharge that amount through your cash ledger. Correct? But in this portal, in GST 9, how it will happen? Because the paid through cash and paid through ITC would be freezed, tax payable would be coming from table number 4 and not from the ITC reversal. Then you have to add this manually here. In fact, one of the cases that we saw, this particular issue of ITC reversal in the tax payable, which was auto-populated also in the table number 9, the same was already added. Means this tax payable they are taking from 3B. They are not taking from your total liability of 1. They are taking this figure from the 3B only and it was automatically added. though you would have shown the same as ITC reversal in the particular table in table number 6. You see all this table number 6 for the ITC reversal is there for table number 7, A, B, C, D for any reasons thereof. But still, the tax payable here has to be accounted for the same. Otherwise, there will be a difference. If you do not want to show it as here, then again, you have to take recourse to table number part B of GST or 9C, where you have to give the same as under comments. Correct. So part 4, table number 9 also, there would be differences on account of 18, 19, 17, 18 taxes paid in 18, 19, which has to be accordingly taken care of. Now, when I come to part 5, basically we have dealt with that 17, 18, the whatever amendments or additions you have shown in 18, 19, or 18, 19, whatever amendments you have shown in 19, 20, those particular parts are here, including ITC and reversal. No particular big issue which is coming up here. Now, I take you to the particular 9s. If I take you to 9C, if we see a particular 9C, again, I just come up just a second. So, if I see a particular 9C now, what is happening? What can be the particular issues in 9C? Because whatever we do in 9, the same would be coming in 9C automatically to whom it is applicable. I'll just take you to 9C, some particular relevant issues and how can disclosures be made so that we can next go to the question answer session and then discuss it openly, correct? So when I go to 9C, the turnover which comes up, see, I have done certain adjustments in table number 50. Adjustments in turnover due to reasons not listed above. Now, many views may be possible here. In my particular view, how I am doing is that if there are certain adjustments, if there is an unreconciled turnover, many people would be keeping the same under unreconciled turnover. But what I am doing, I am showing all the adjustments in table 50, and in table number 6, I am giving the reasons of such adjustment. There may be interest income there, which is exempt income. There may be miscellaneous revenues which are not a part of GST or which is not a supply as per GST. So all those reconciliations would come up here. My major issue which I take you to would be the reconciliation of tax paid issue in table number 9 of 9C. So this tax paid particular table which is there, the amount of GST 9 is coming automatically in table number 9Q. But the amount which you have to give rate-wise breakup of reverse charge liability as well as your forward charge liability, this should come from your books of accounts. Now you again go to 9, what I told you, when you have to take the reference from your books of accounts. So when you put the figures here from books of accounts and you show and you compare it with your annual return, there may be reasons of reconciliation on account of 17, 18 if you have not corrected your annual return. Say if you have filed your annual return as per the auto-drafted details, then when you try to compare the books of accounts liability rate-wise with the annual return figure, you will see there is a difference. There may be a difference in the tax amount as per your books because the major reason of that difference can be that in your annual return, you have also accounted for certain 17-18 liabilities in 18-19 and you have not deleted in your GST 9 of 18-19. And therefore, the 18-19 output tax payable is coming more then whatever is booked in your books of accounts, and then you have to give the same under reasons. But the better approach would be to disclose GST 9 correctly so that there will not be any unreconciled tax payable amount in this particular table. Similarly, when we go to the reconciliation of input tax credit in the table number 12 of 9C, see 12A, B, C, these are three very important. 12A is your books of accounts credit. Net of reversals, whatever you have availed and whatever you have reversed, you have to give that figure. But 12B, ITC booked in earlier financial year, claimed in current financial year. This is very important. You have this figure, you have to again go back to your GST 9 of table 13, wherein of 17-18, where you have disclosed ITC of 17-18 taken in 18-19. So this figure would be coming up there. 12B, you have to take recourse to GST 9 table number 13 and 9 table number 13 of 17-18 to fill in this particular table. If you miss it, again, there will be issues of reconciliation which you are not able to reconcile because in the GST 9 of 17-18, you had categorically mentioned that, okay, these invoices credit, I have availed in 18-19 financial year. But my accounting was done in 17-18 only. So the amount is not coming in 12A because it is not accounted in the books in the particular expense head in the particular financial year 18-19. But since 17-18, some credits are being carried forward, which you have availed in 18-19, that disclosure becomes important here. Similarly, 12C. 12C says you have booked the ITC in your books in the current financial year, but you have not availed in 3B of the current financial year. You have availed in 3B of maybe 19-20. That figure has to be deducted because the comparison is being made by the 3B ITC figures, which you have availed in 3B of 18-19 only. If you have availed any credit of 18-19 in 19-20, again, you have to go to table number 13 of GST 9 of 18-19, wherein the figures from that particular year can be matched. If the records can be taken, or maybe you have disclosed that particular figure in table number 8C also, then also the difference, you have to put in relevant figures here. And then the comparison happens with the annual return. And once this comparison happens with the annual return, you can get a total output like reconciliation of ITC and reasons, if any. Last table number 14 for 18-19 and 17-18, government has stated you may not give this particular advice reconciliation. But I will again suggest that it is very important for us to have certain expense rate, very important expense rate-wise reconciliation, which would include your GTA-related reverse charges expense head. So what happens whenever the department comes for audit after 3 years or 2 years, then they will have the recourse to your balance sheet. They will say, okay, in your balance sheet, in your indirect expenses, you have shown carriage outward 10 lakhs. You give me a reconciliation that if this 10 lakhs has suffered reverse charge under GTA service or not. So if you do not prepare this reconciliation while doing your 9C, after 3 years when the department comes and the SSC tells you, sir, ye prepare karke lijiye, then it bahut kharab lagta us samay. Yaar, ye to 17-18 ka main aaj 21-22 mein kyun karun? So it becomes very important for all of us to make sure to have a reconciliation of RCM at least, reverse charge mechanism taxes that you have paid in the financial year with your books of accounts, and not only with books of accounts, with your audited financial statement. Because books of account trials contains many ledgers, but when it goes into audited financial statements, the ledgers get grouped. So accordingly, that grouping should be there and you should match it with your total GLs so that you can prove to the department that yes, this reconciliation I have already done, I have paid my taxes. In fact, as a very precautionary measure in the audits that I do or whatever we do from our firm, we make it a point that we upload the total RCM annexure, RCM details with the 9C copy in the portal so that department cannot tell us after 3 years that this has not been disclosed to us. As a matter of abundant precaution, I try to upload the total ITC invoice level annexure also with my 2A reconciliation with my 9C audit report so that information is not furnished by the SSC. These things may not be coming up and the department will not be able to invoke Section 74 in times to come, because I have already given all the information to the department ready. So these particular issues again comes up there. And now lastly is the part B, which is the certification part. Basically, it may be stated to be unfortunate also that people are not commenting here. Part B may not, it is not only disqualification, it says your observations. So if you have any observation also, it may not be qualification of the report of the SSC. Observation may be like the SSC has paid taxes through DRC 03. We have verified the same. The SSC has filed the delayed filed in GST 3B of a month and he has paid interest on net basis. You should mention these in your audit report so that as an abundant precaution, your membership is saved. You can bring out quality audit also and the reconciliations and everything can come smoothly when the department comes for the audit. So these are some of the issues which I foresee, which I think was relevant when you go to it, when you are doing actually 18-19 annual return and annual audit. Now I think I'll thank you DPPA for giving me this opportunity to sharing my thoughts. And if any further questions are there on this topic or Rohit Bhaiya's topic, we can cumulatively take it for the next 15-20 minutes. Thank you. Thank you, dear sir.
Thank you, Ankit, for a wonderful deliberation, as always.
Thank you, sir.
I really sometimes envy the energy with which Ankit speaks. And his passion about the subject is really admirable, I must say. Now, I see some questions on the chat box. I think most of the questions are for Rohit to address.
Yes, I...
Yeah.
Dear sir, with your permission, can I take...
Sure, sir. Please start.
So, one question was about discounts. Early payment discounts or cash discounts, etc. See, let us first understand the law about discount. The law about discount in GST is given in section 15, subsection 3. Where while value of supply, they say the value of supply shall not exclude discount, which means you do not have to pay GST on discount only if certain conditions are satisfied. What are those conditions? Condition number one, before the supply, that discount has to be announced by an agreement or by any letter or etc. That discount has to be specifically announced. That, so for example, in your query, the supplier must have said prior in a letter or in an agreement that, ki boss, if you pay me within this date, I'm going to give you an early payment discount or a cash discount. That is one. Second is that discount must be given by way of a credit note where invoices against which such discount is given must be specifically mentioned, because section 15, subsection 3, clause B, clause 1 clearly says that discount has to be specifically linked to relevant invoices, which means whatever credit note you are issuing, in that credit note or in the annexure to the credit note, you must specifically mention that this discount is given against early payment of invoice number 1, 2, 3, 4. So these two things are very important. If these two things are satisfied, then obviously you can adjust the discount, adjust the credit note from the invoice and reduce the GST liability. Important condition after you issue is that the recipient also should reduce the ITC it has taken on your earlier invoice. So, three things cumulatively has to be satisfied. One, discount, cash discount has to be announced by way of agreement or a writing letter or something like that, that the supplier will give you a cash discount on payment within this day. Second, the credit note when the supplier issued must mention the invoices against which that cash payment discount has been given. And the third, when discount is given through credit note with GST reduction, the ITC claimed by recipient also has to be reduced. So I hope your question is answered. Now, somebody asked me, what do you mean by linking to relevant invoices? As I just explained, whenever you give a sales return, purchase return or a discount, you give those discounts against a particular invoice. You return goods which were supplied earlier with a reference of an invoice. So, whenever you issued a credit or debit note, in that credit note, debit note on the body or on the annexure, you should give the reference of the invoice against which that discount is given, which is basically linking of credit note, debit note to the invoices. Next question to me was ISD, Input Service Distributor, where let's say you have multiple branches. Out of, let's say, 10 branches, two were operating only for 5 months. Now, there are various scenarios in this. You have answered one scenario. You have questioned me on one scenario. I will give you multiple scenarios on this. For example, I am in the year 2021. 1920, in the year 1920, there were 10 branches operating. Out of 10 branches, two were operating for 6 months and the balance for 12 months. Now, section 20 clearly says that the ISD has to be distributed to all the branches pro rata on the basis of the turnover in that state during the relevant period. So, if two branches had turnover only for 6 months and the balance for 12 months, my ITC dispersal will take place on the basis of those turnover only. Now, I'll take another case. Let's say that branch was operating in the last year, but that branch is not operating in the current year. Then I will not distribute the credit to the branch which is not operating in the current year, because section 20 clearly says that the ISD has to be distributed to those branches which are operational in the current year. Now, I will take a third scenario. Assuming a branch has come, this which had no turnover last year, where no turnover was available last year, then the law gives me an option that the relevant period can be taken as the last financial year preceding the year to which I am distributing the credit, or to the last quarter for which the details of such turnover was available, previous to the month to which I am distributing the credit. So, if the turnover was not available at all in the last financial year, but it is available in the quarter before which I am distributing the credit, I can take that turnover credit for that quarter and distribute the credit accordingly. Yes, so I think...
I'll take one question which is...
Yeah, Ankit.
One question has been asked by Rajat ji, that if we have paid excess tax in 1789, how we will treat in 9 of 1819? Sir, if you have paid excess tax in GST 9, then I believe you have already filed a refund claim under Section 54 after filing the GST 9. We need to understand what do you mean by excess payment of tax. Things become difficult, say, if you have paid a tax to GST 3B, correct? You are already, when you are paying the taxes, you are already setting off the same amount. So, in your cash ledger, there is no amount which is shown as available to you for which you can claim a refund in case of excess payment of tax. If during your GST 9 of 1789-99C, you come out with a reconciliation which shows, okay, you had to pay 1 lakh, but you had paid 1,10,000. So the question is, how do you get this 10,000 back from the department? So for this 10,000, since this amount is not lying in your cash ledger, or if you can, it is not lying in your cash ledger, first option is, you have to go to when the department comes for an assessment, at that moment of time, if they agree to your reconciliation, then it will happen. Next option can be, subject to time limitation of Section 54, if you can identify month on month basis, which particular month of the 1718, you had paid excess tax, then there is an option to file excess payment of tax refund under 54 in the GST portal, for after selecting the relevant month in which you identified. Now, you will say, no, sir, it is on a cumulative basis. So, that is what is the issue. When you say it is on a cumulative basis for a total financial year, you have paid excess payment of tax, things becomes very difficult to claim refund, and you have to wait till the department comes for your assessment and does the audit, and then only you can verify then whether that particular refund is actually eligible or not. That is what my point is on the same.
Yeah, Rohit, I think the next question is for you.
The early payment discount, I already explained it to you. Now, in which form of GST shall we disclose such discount? So, first of all, the discount shall be given by the way of, let's say, credit note. That credit note will be disclosed in 3B by way of reducing the turnover. So, whatever output tax or supplies you are showing in the month in which you are filing GST 3B, you will deduct it from the turnover. If it is discount, you deduct it. If there is no turnover in that month, then you, in 3B, you cannot show the negative figure. So, you take it into the next month, 3B. In GST R1, you have credit notes where B2B credit notes can be given by giving invoice reference. So, in the GST R1, you will show the credit note with reference to the invoice against which it is given. So, both in both 3B and both GST R1, you have to show this discount through credit note.
Any other question? Someone was raising hands actually. If you want Shubham, SKP, if you want to ask some question, you can.
Yeah, hello.
Yeah.
Sir, my query is to Ankit, sir. Sir, my query is related to refund of excess payment of tax. Like, yes, while doing GST on 9th of financial year 1718, we came across that we have paid excess tax in the month of December 17. We have also filed refund of excess payment of tax. But due to time limitation of 2 years, department is denying the refund. They are saying that as 2 years have passed, so we will not allow the refund.
Sir, time limit, it is the course of law over a period of time. Section 50, I can take you back to Excise Law 11B. There is a classical judgment of Honorable Supreme Court in case of Mafatlal Industries, which had even stated that if it was not payable and still you have paid it, it cannot be refunded to you if you exceed the time limit. Recently, 2019, there is a ITC Limited judgment of Honorable Supreme Court again, which came through the Calcutta High Court,
And there also the Honorable Supreme Court has recently in 2019 held that no, for any reasons, indirect tax is a self-assessment thing. If you have paid excess tax and you are trying to claim a refund after the statutory time period, there is no question of refund. But you will find out that in excise and service tax laws, there are many judicial pronouncements at statute level, at high court level, which takes reference to Article 246 and Article 300 of the Constitution of India. And they say that something which cannot be collected is not payable. The government cannot enrich itself upon that. So if you can take those particular recourse and fight your claim, then only you have to go into litigation for this. But the government is very clear that anything after time limitation, they are not going to give you a refund of that.
Any other question?
So there's one question from Amrit Jain.
Amrit Jain,
reconciliation sheet we should attach along with our GST audit report, sir. I told you when you file your 9C, once you have uploaded the offline utility, then you two attachment PL balance sheet is must you have to give. But the total you can attach there in there are total four boxes in which you can attach two documents each. And 5 MB of each document is allowed. So as an auditor, what I am doing, I told you I am giving all the reconciliations, all my RCM reconciliations, all my 2A reconciliations, in fact, I am giving ITC statement in some cases also, wherein I find I have taken some litigative ITC. Then in that cases, I am giving that particular statement also as a PDF and attaching that in my audit report, and then the SSC is filing the DSC. So you can very well attach your reconciliation sheet after the 9C, all whatever is your reconciliation, extra reconciliation that you need to provide with the 9C.
I did not understand the next question. We are declaring credit note for debtor party in salary paid to PSR. But there is no such original invoice to link that credit note. So it shows,
Yogesh, please.
I think the issue is relating to in the portal, when you give a credit note, they have to give an invoice reference number. Portal, though the law has been amended, but the portal has not been amended. So he's trying to show that error is coming, which invoice number I should put.
No, but it is saying that debtor party in salary paid to PSR. What is the debtor party in salary paid to PSR?
Yogesh, you can...
Hello.
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 Yogesh, you can ask a question.
Hello.
Yeah, Yogesh.
Yeah, Yogesh, you can ask your
question. I'm audible, sir.
Yeah, you are audible.
Yeah, you are audible.
Sir, we are issuing credit note.
Yes, please.
For salary paid to agent, company agent. To the party which we are selling the goods.
Sorry, Yogesh, salary paid to agent. Agent has to be your employee if you pay him salary.
No, not employee. Sorry, company's agent.
You are using debit note or credit note?
Credit note, we are issuing credit note, but there is no original invoice to link that credit note. That's why it shows error message in GSTR1.
You do not know the original invoice against which credit note is issued. Are you saying
yes.
That?
Yes.
So see, the law has been amended now where linking is not allowed. Prior to that and up till 1920, linking was mandatory. So if you do not have invoice linking, then that adjustment will not be allowed.
Okay, sir.
Then there is a question, Amrit Jain again, bifurcation of ITC is difficult. Sir, 17, 18, 18, 19, government has given you a relaxation that you show everything in input in table number 6. But saying difficult will not help your cause of action because the new returns which is proposed from September, maybe not September coming year again, in that it is compulsory that you have to give the bifurcation. So the more earlier that you can have the bifurcation ready in your books of accounts, the more better for you and your SSC. ITC bifurcation on raises? You are talking about the last table, the purchase one, the reconciliation. So that I told you, maybe for the particular heads, like purchase, freight, wherein it is possible, because you see they are giving you a miscellaneous any other expense 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 also. So my request would be you make reconciliations for the direct heads, at least like freight, purchases, your direct expenses, sponsorship, things like that. And expenses which you find that it is not being reconciled, put it under the any other expense head and do not show that you have availed any ITC. So you have to manage it accordingly. Maybe they have deferred it for 18, 19. You never know what they do it for 19, 20 and 21 also.
Any more questions, please? Yeah, one more.
Sir, what is to be done in case ITC claimed as per 3B is more than 2A in GST 9? Sir, I told you in my humble opinion, there is no reversal required. You prepare your reconciliation. You have to fight that 16-2C. Cannot claim your credit. There are Supreme Court judgment in case of Delhi VAT and Punjab Haryana VAT, which says that on the non-compliance of vendor, customer cannot be penalized. That if you can prove that you have paid your tax, you have paid the taxes to your vendor also. So I, in my view, you should not file any pay, make any reversals of ITC in case of difference between 2A and 3B. We have question from one expert, Mr. Vikas.
Ankit, you asked a question to Vikas when he was the speaker, right?
Yes, I know. Yes. Ankit ji, can time limit will apply in case of excess payment? Sir, 54, see, excess payment, I tell you, two years when you go to 54, it's a general time limit they are speaking of. So, I told in the answer that when the department comes for the assessment, they will also verify your records that, okay, whether you have actual claim or not. And if after that department passes an order, then I think you can file a refund claim within that limit also. Yes, please, Pankaji, please speak.
Yeah, Vikas.
Because if you see 54, sir, Vikash Banka ji ko thoda unmute kariye.
Sure. Yeah, Vikash.
Ha, can you hear me, Ankit ji?
Yes, sir, I can hear you. Tell me, sir, please.
Sir, section 54.1 talks about the time limit for the excess payment of tax. And whatever I have made the excess payment, that is not the tax at all. Since I was not liable to pay tax, number one.
Correct, sir.
And number two.
Correct, but there is a mafat.
Number two, sir. Sir, second thing is under section 54.1, the relevant date and the explanation does not cover in such case. You see the relevant date, it covers the export, yes. It covers the service, sir, the service provided, goods received, etc., etc. But does not cover.
They are not given.
Especially they have not given. Yes, so in such case, whether it will be enforceable.
Sir, that is what I told you. It is not given specifically, but any other amount, tax and interest, if any other amount paid by the applicant, if he has not passed on the incidence, if you see the relevant date, the general date, in any other case, date of payment of tax is mentioned in the relevant date.
But it is not a tax at all, na?
So that is what I told you. Then you have to go to Constitution and you have to say Parliament cannot enrich itself on which is not payable at all. But
unjust enrichment, you are talking about unjust enrichment.
No, not unjust enrichment. Department cannot, the government cannot enrich itself on a tax which is not a tax at all. There is a specific clause in the constitution for that. I have recently fought this case in Calcutta Sested myself for one of my SSC. I have got a favorable judgment because there was a favorable judgment of the Honorable Delhi Sested on the same issue. But department took that case to High Court in service tax regime. My own case, I can give you an example. High Court dismissed the appeal of the department on monetary grounds because it was below 50 lakhs. But there is a very high chance that there is, after the Supreme Court judgment in ITC Limited, I can share that judgment with you all after the session over. Then you read it and the Supreme Court has clearly remarked in case of indirect self-assessment basis, if you come to me after time limit, there is no cause of action which can be entertained at all. So that thing is very important for us to note, which will have its role.
My point is, Ankit ji, no. Second point, there is no specific relevant date given for this payment of.
For that, I will say any other case is there. It says for any other case, the date of payment of tax. So I think it will be covered. Department can very well cover it there. Okay. The residual clause.
Okay. Thank you.
We have another 90 days now. And now the lockdown has been extended. So we'll have another advanced session on this, all these issues.
Correct, sir. In that we will be audience, you will be speaking.
No, I'm doing my job here as a moderator. Another question is from Nidhi Jaiswal.
Yes, suppose we have wrongly paid IGST instead of CA and S for 18-19 and a time limit for correction is gone, then how we are going to treat the same in 9? So ma'am, in table 9, I will tell you, when you file your GST on 9, now since you know that it was C and S payable instead of I, then what you do in table number 4, when you disclose this particular thing in table number 4 in case of B2B or B2C, you disclose the correct amount there. You disclose the same in C and S side only. And when it comes to the tax reconciliation in table number 9, then it will be shown that there is a difference between CGST, SGST and IGST liability, which you can pay through DRC03. And for the tax which has been paid incorrectly in IGST, you file a refund claim for the same. But you have to show it. You show it in table number 4 correctly. Please note.
I think no more questions.
Now one more question has come in table number 9, tax payable. Whether the amount paid as per 3B to be mentioned, sir. Table number 9, tax payable is coming from table number 4. So when it is coming from table number 4, you have to ensure you have to give everything correct in table number 4. 3B may be incorrect, 1 may be incorrect, but table number 4 of GST 9 has to be correct and that figure will auto-populate there.
The last question seems to be for Shivani, but she is not here. Air travel.
Correct.
Ankit, please.
Yeah, I'll see, sir. Sure. When air travel agent paid 18% GST on service charges and not follow the rule 32, it is shown in GST 3B and 1, its ticket sale as exempted supply. It is shown in GST 3B and 1 is ticket sale as exempt supply. Now it is received notice. Joint Department told that since you have not exempt, you have to follow. What should be done in that case? Purchase ticket on a principal agent. Devjani ji, in that case, see, department is correct in issuing notices because GST 9, you are, or 9-3B, you are yourself telling it to be an exempted supply. Then, of course, they will take you to Rule 42 for that purpose. But in that case, I would tell you, you have to give it with proper reasoning that, okay, rules is telling me to do 5% of the base fare of the air ticket. But what I have done, I have acting as a pure agent and I have just given GST on my service charges. You have to make a case of the same. But, and if you can prove what ITC you have availed, that is to be checked. Whether you have availed any ITC apart from your air travel agent business, then things may be complicated, but if it is a direct credit, all credits are direct in your relation to business, then you have a very good case to show, though, say, it is not at all a supply, it is just a reimbursement which has been shown incorrectly as exempted supply. So an incorrect disclosure cannot lead to any subsequent reversal in any case, in my view.
She is saying no ITC claim.
So no ITC claim, then it is, there cannot be any case for you then. There cannot be any Rule 42 case at all. Since you are just paying tax on service charges, you have to give it a proper reply to the department stating what process you have followed and how you have disclosed it.
Yeah, one question.
I will give you the judgments copy which we have referred, sir. Supreme Court judgment in ITC and Mafatlal, these two judgments which I have referred. I'll share the judgment copy with you. Maybe you can circulate it too with everyone.
Sure. One from AC to one question. Tax payable can be modified in table 9?
Tax payable can be modified, not paid. Tax payable is coming from GSTR. It can be easily modified. It is coming from table 4. Whatever you put in table 4, it will be automatically modified to that extent.
No more questions. Yeah. Shall we conclude here, Ankit and Rohit?
Yes, sir.
Yes,
yeah,
please.
All the questions have entered in. Thank you very much to both our learned speakers for a wonderful deliberation and for taking all the questions from the participants. This 6 days webinar, which we planned during the course of lockdown, seeing the number of participants, it was really great. And I see some comments from the participants also, which is really admirable, which really give us more this thing to organize such type of webinars in future also. And today's Pehla Baisakh, and known by different names in different parts of the country. I wish you all the best. And this being the trying time, we are staying home. Please follow the guidelines issued by the government. And today also, Honorable Prime Minister says, Saath unki sapadi, uska aap log palan kare, stay home, stay safe. Bahar jada venture na kare. And take care of your family, take care of yourself. With this, now, I'll regarding as the lockdown has further been extended till 3rd of May, we'll at DTP GST committee with our presidents and advisors, we'll discuss can we organize some more webinars during next phase of lockout. With this, I'll now request our secretary, C. Rajesh Jagarwal, to offer a vote of thanks. Thank you.
Good afternoon to everyone. On behalf of DTP and myself, I thank to both the speaker of the today webinar, Mr. Ankit Kanodia and Mr. Rohit Surana. I also would like to thank to the GST subcommittee of our association, advisor Sri Vikas Parak, chairman Sri G.S. Agarwal ji, and co-chair Sri Ankit Kanodia ji for organizing such wonderful GST workshop. I also thanks to all the participants for joining the six-day workshop of GST. And I also thank to Information Technology Subcommittee for organizing such nice arrangement for the webinar. Thanks to all.
Thank you, D.S. Agarwalaji, and thank you, Rajesh Agarwalaji, for being a wonderful host. It was really a pleasure to be here and speaking amidst all of you. Thank you so much.
I reciprocate the same.
Thank you, Ankit.
Thanks to all. See you all soon. See you all soon with the next series of the webinar. Thanks to all.
Thank you. Thanks to this previous year.
Thank you very much.
Thank you all the participants. Thank you very much.
Thanks to all. Thanks. Take care.